step down.
You'll be right back.
I don't know if I am getting a cold, but I sure feel like it, so I'm pumping up on all this stuff. Three or four different ones of these.
Are those coldies?
No, I have coldies too. I like coldies. They make everything taste like metal.
Vitamin C.
Oh, vitamin C, yeah. This just came up today or yesterday evening. I thought I was just tired.
Vitamin C is really
good. I'll buy a half gallon of orange juice or something.
No, take the vitamin C.
Well, I already do.
I need this tonight. I don't need this.
So anyway, but that's... I just wanted to make sure. You look a lot better than you did last year.
Thanks.
Yeah,
feels
you
a lot better.
Yeah, he doesn't have his shadow with him.
Carrying your cylinder around?
Nope, not anymore.
I actually got on my bike today.
Good for you.
Good.
My first time, which is kind of a milestone.
Yeah, it is.
1 minute after.
I know it's late. I'm sorry.
Okay, so I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
He's here. He's ready to
where
go.
To point my finger if there's a subsequent problem. No, anyway. Yeah.
He just brought a brand new document.
I haven't looked at it.
That's it. It's on the other side of that.
I'm going to put this away.
Let me call the Berkley City Planning Commission to order for its regular meeting of Tuesday, October the 25th, 2016. Would you all please rise for the pledge to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Could I have a roll call, Ms. Hansen?
Martin Smith?
Here.
Tangeri?
Here.
Richardson?
Here.
Shadle?
Here.
Murad?
Here.
Pop?
Here.
Dean Smith?
Here.
Buckler?
Present.
Barnett?
Present. Now I'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda this evening.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Murad. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Shadle. Is there any discussion on the agenda? Hearing none, I'll take a roll call vote, please.
Martin Smith?
Yes.
Buckler?
Yes.
Tangeri?
Yes.
Shadle?
Yes.
Pop?
Yes.
Dean Smith?
Yes.
Murad?
Yes.
Richardson?
Yes.
Barnett?
Yes. Okay, we're down to the minutes of the September 27th meeting, 2016. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Martin Smith.
You know, apparently there was a lot of discussion regarding the details of the minutes. Now, Amy went through and she passed them along to us, and I went through them all. You're furiously writing these things down as people talk, and some of it gets missed. And I guess what some people are asking is that there's more detail in it. Now, and don't get me wrong, I go to a lot of communities. Some are more detailed. Some are transcripts from the video. In some communities. Other communities are totally glossed over. So we're in the middle, typically, is what we do. Is there a value of holding this off for a month? And is that something that, you have a three-hour meeting, it could be 20 pages long. And
if the Planning Commission has specific items they want to have adjusted, then give those to me. What I have is what I wrote down. So if there's something that you want to, that you feel that would be, certainly they're not transcripted.
Of course.
The best record is the videotape. That's obviously has everything as it happened. And So the if you want specific things adjusted, you can do that. If you want to postpone and get those to me, however you want to do it. But I, you know, to ask me to go through, I think it would be...
I don't want a transcript, and I don't know what everybody else wants. I mean, that gets ridiculous, you know, when we have 2 and 3 hour meetings sometimes. There's just, and especially when some things are repeated over and over again, there's just no point on transcripting the whole thing. And I've, as I said, I've been to them where you look at, and it's a 25-page single line document of the minutes. And the video is there to back it up. I'd like to see a little more detail. I don't know how the rest of the commissioners feel.
Mr. Chair.
Please.
It's your turn, Gary.
I think it's if it was just a matter of level of detail, I would be fine with the minutes as they are. But I think that a couple of the citizens who contacted the city had the sense that their comments weren't accurately reflected. And I think that because that is the complaint, I would like to postpone approval of the minutes so that those comments can be incorporated, because essentially if any planning commissioner were to feel that what they said was inaccurately recorded in the minutes, we would be able to ask for the minutes to be amended. And I think that extending the same courtesy to the residents makes a certain amount of sense.
Absolutely, but to what degree? That's my question.
Well, I mean, like you say, it doesn't have to be a transcript, but I think that we do have some very specific requests for amendment of the minutes to reflect mm-hmm. what citizens felt they were saying. Mm-hmm. And I think that we can use the text that was provided to us. It might not be word for word, but I think that in order to capture the meaning of what citizens intended to say, we can use what they sent as a reference point.
There's a difference of what someone intended to say. I walk out of here every meeting saying, I should have said. So it's a matter of what was said.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, and I read through them all. I read them very carefully, but I don't recall if that was what was really said. And I'm not trying to change anything here. But the record is the video.
Right.
Now, do we ask Amy to go through the video and pick out the pertinent? I that's why I'm asking.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's the absolute transcript of the meeting, which, again, is a ridiculous thing.
Right.
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Buckler.
So as someone who has been before city councils and other planning commissions and other areas of the state through my career, I can say that our minutes are typical and meet the standard of most minutes for
Absolutely.
These kinds of meetings. And with video backup, I think that, you know, is the official record. The minutes are kind of giving the little bit of a 10,000-foot view with some detail. But I respect your opinion, Mr. Tangeri, but I really think it just won't... It won't end, like, until you get to a complete transcript,
right.
Because until you've every individual that spoke that had their meaning, you know, or the true words. I think the video is the transcript. The meaning. I was not at the meeting because I was traveling for work, but I had a very strong idea of what went on, and of course I watched the video as well. But I think that is a good record, and to. If anyone has ever actually had to take notes during a meeting, particularly with fast-paced and with getting all the information, I think Ms. Vanson does a very nice job of that and captures it. And it is the standard by which I would think almost every, unless they have a transcriber, a court transcriber taking them, which we don't, and no city council does, and no other planning commission does, or zoning board of appeals, I think we're doing a very good job, and it's no different than what has gone on, and it reflects, you know, what was captured, and that's my opinion. So, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Shano.
I agree with all three of you. I think that... my concern is that we do start down a slippery slope to a transcribed meeting, and maybe there's a reasonable solution to that, if that's the path that we're going down. I don't know. That's a concern. However, the process that we have in place is one that folks are currently using, which is come and say, hey, this has not reflected the spoken word. I'd like for the spoken word to be reflected. And that's our current process. So I think I personally would like to honor that. If it becomes a pattern, it becomes extremely cumbersome, then I think we have to readdress it at some point in the future. But I think residents have very specifically said, this is what I said, this was not reflected, I'd like for what I said to be reflected, and I'd like to honor the current process.
Other comments?
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Dean Smith?
I too read through several emails regarding comments on the minutes, and my first reaction was, when we go through our minutes, often what is in there is not word for word what I said, mm-hmm. but it certainly covers what I meant. Mm-hmm. In this case, we have a lot of activity, a lot of speeches that are being read into the record. My suggestion would be that we would take and put somewhere in the header or beginning of the minutes that the minutes, you know, have been videoed, and they're available on the city website, www, and they are the official record. I would also, you know, there was one comment in there, and I think it was Kurt Height, that said, you know, the law or the regulation has to do with how much time is spent. Like, say, if you're discussing two sides, how much time is spent on one side and how much time is spent on the other. That was interesting and also appropriate. When you've got, say, 50 people that come up and speak and 49 of them are, you know, have taken issue with something that we are doing or talking about doing, and one supports, comment that there is overwhelming public comment in this direction is, to me, should be sufficient. In addition to making the note that the Planning Commission meetings are on video and available through the city website, I would also add a little note that they're a summary of activity, and they're not meant to be word for word. Word for word comes on the video. And just by way of adding some level of detail that shouldn't be burdensome for Amy, what time did each section start and stop? You know, if public comments are 3 minutes, no big deal. If public comments are 37 minutes, if it's noted in the meeting minutes or the summary that there was 37 minutes of public comment, that should give the reader of the minutes cause to say, hey, I better watch this video. There might be something good on there. But I'm very concerned that if we start saying, well, this isn't what I said, and we start editing minutes, we're going to go through several months of iterations mm-hmm. until we get to no place further than we were by looking at the video. So I would be leery of trying to add a lot of detail. In fact, I'd be pushing the other way. Mm-hmm. You know, less detail and more directional.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Richardson.
To the best of my understanding, minutes are not intended to be a transcript. They're just not, and never were. I'm wondering, though, if is there a way for this body to append the emails that we got to the minutes as an attachment, and note that they were received. If we can do that, then those emails become a part of the official record, I think, of our proceedings. And
they are.
And they're then, you know, on record for anyone to, any member of the public to review or obtain. Would that be the best way to resolve this?
I believe all communications are part of the public record, and they go in the file. Okay. For the with meeting notes. Is that correct?
They would be in the file. If you added it as appendix to the minutes, it would actually go into the clerk's office, keeps records of all of the minutes.
Okay.
So it would actually be in their big red books that look very ancient, but aren't okay. So ancient.
I don't know the answer for sure. I share the concerns about having you rewrite minutes, Ms. Vanson, because there's already a level of dissatisfaction. What do? Just keep rewriting them. Until who knows when. But we do have these comments, and they should be acknowledged.
But, Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Martinson?
But rather than the emails being the record, the video is the record of what was actually said. So, with our summary, refer, maybe it's a standard paragraph in there. We have our, the city of Berkley. It says official minutes are stored. Official minutes and video of the meeting on such and such a date is stored. That becomes the official record. Because I could send emails in. Well, here's what I said. Here's what I said. And as time goes by, and as I slap my forehead, my interpretation of what I thought I said is different.
Right.
The record is the video record. Emails can be added to it. That's fine. Of concerns, but that is not the record as far as I'm concerned. Because it's not, and I do it all the time, it's not what I meant to say, it's what I actually said. And I think that's the direction we want to go if we want to call that the official record of the minutes is the video, not the emails or me saying a month later, well, here's what I really meant to say even though I said this. I don't think that's right.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Shadow.
I have no issue having that discussion going forward. I think, I go back and I feel pretty strongly about this is the current process that's in place. Mm-hmm. And residents have utilized that process. What I'm not in favor of is saying we're going to change the process when it has already been started in this particular case. Absolutely. My concern is the slippery slope. I think we can, put disclosures on there to certainly help this in the future. I think that's a very reasonable thing to do. But at this point, we have residents who have asked that the minutes be amended and corrected. I do think it will take us some time to do that because somebody has to sit and watch the video and just confirm that what was asked to be amended, that what was said is what was said, and that's fine.
You have a secretary.
Be careful what you wish for, and that's fine. So I have a big hesitancy this time in not following the process as I understand it at the moment.
So, Mr. Chair, so playing devil's advocate for a moment, what happens if a comment comes in where the minutes are in contrast to that comment? What do we do then? Mm-hmm. Because, and I'm not saying that that's happened, but we're on the slippery slope.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
We can't just think one step down. We have to think 10 steps down, and what is the eventual outcome here? It's how much, we have infinite, we do not have infinite resources. We have finite resources. Mm-hmm. How much do we have to go back and forth where Amy is forced with having to now write back, this individual wrote in, this is what they meant to say, the record actually reflects what they did say, so now we get into a little match back and forth. So, we have not encountered this, mm-hmm. to my knowledge, mm-hmm. at least while I've been on commission. Now, Mr. Smith and Mr. Smith have been here forever, so maybe they've encountered this before. Mm-hmm. But the process that we are using in Berkley is no different or little different than most other community.
Absolutely.
In the metro area, and while I kind of like, Mark, I like your idea that they become an amendment or an attachment.
Not an amendment, but an attachment.
I like that idea that it's an attachment. Yeah. So somebody can read that and get a thorough, review of what was said and or go back and review the tapes, which mm-hmm. takes a lot of time.
Absolutely.
And not everybody has that time or access. But I like that idea. Because unless there's something glaringly wrong that we have, and it's very rare that we have a comment on the minutes, it really is just either it's usually a typo or something that got overlooked. I mean, typically. So I think we get into that slippery slope because I do want the residents heard, absolutely. But I also recognize that we have a process. The process is what it is. It's imperfect, but it is what it is. And our resources are finite.
Absolutely.
And we near City Plan are doing more than just rewriting minutes after minutes, because then we get into the City Council minutes, we get into the ZBA minutes, and it never, ever, ever, ever will end. That
absolutely.
Is my concern.
Absolutely. Absolutely agree.
I think open the floodgate.
You're right, which is why I am trying to find that middle ground that says the attachment is certainly a plausible solution. What I don't want to do is disregard the current process that the residents have for setting the minutes in their mind to reflect what was said. And we have a finite number of requests to do that this time around. Yes, it will absolutely take time and resources to address the number of concerns that we have. And to me, and again, maybe it's my ignorance, but it's black and white. I mean, we have the videotape. This is what was said.
That's what was said.
Right? So if what's being requested matches what was said, I don't see where there's an issue. Mm-hmm. And again, going forward, I don't know, again, we don't have the resources to do this every time, but this is the current process. So I'd like to see it addressed with respect to the residents and them following the current process that they have for requesting that the minutes be amended, changed, whatnot.
So what you're asking is that we do it as an attachment to this to the minutes. Does that mm-hmm. sound like an appropriate thing, Mr. Dean Smith?
Well, I heard Ms. Shadle say something different than that.
Yes, so did I. I'm not sure what she...
My preference, just... You want to be fair, you want to be brief, and you want to be accurate. That all fits in the video. Mm-hmm. So by tagging the summary that we have here and saying for the detail, refer to the video, we really need people to watch the video. I do not see any value whatsoever in producing a word-by-word transcript of our meetings. I think it becomes too long, too difficult to read,
becomes very cumbersome.
The value goes down.
Yeah.
To specifically why I asked about putting in time slots.
That's a great idea.
At 7:52, we move to this section of the meeting. At 7:63, that would be 8:03, we move to this section of the meeting. Then it allows the person that is watching on the video to fast forward through to the point that they want to see. I would much prefer brevity in use of existing technology. When the emails come, my understanding is that emails now are part of the permanent city record, and it's really a question of which pile they go in. And they're there. They can be FOIA'd. But now do we want to start putting emails received from residents on the city website? I'm not sure that's the direction we want to go.
I don't know mechanically how it happens. one could amend the minutes to say, and some emails were received from citizens regarding the meeting, and then direct the reader to wherever those are stored. In the spirit of acknowledging that we get those emails.
Yeah. In no way, shape, or form would I want to ignore input, because this is good stuff. There's a lot of valuable information that comes in. Mm-hmm. But how do we keep it workable? And how do we keep from burying our employees here with paper?
I don't think we should... We should rewrite the minutes. I think we should figure out a way to acknowledge the communications we've received.
Go ahead.
Well, I'm. That's my comment.
Okay. I have a comment.
You go ahead.
So the way I'm looking at this is a couple things in listening now. I like Dean's idea with the timestamps. So, mm-hmm. you know, that was my thought. I was like, great, that's a great idea, because yeah. you can jump to the section you want to, you're interested in seeing. And I like the idea of putting, like, a line in the minutes that says where you can find the video from the meeting on the city website, directly a full link to where it could go, okay. rather than just saying you can find it on the city website and give the location of the city website. Put a full link right to where the video is, so if they're looking at the minutes online, they can just click that link and it would take them right to the video. I'm fine with the emails and any other correspondence being in a, like an attachment to it. And I think there was also some, in some of the emails sent to you, questioning about some of the handouts that people give us. And then my question on that really for you, Amy, is that go in as part of our, the you know, our monthly package?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So then they are part of the record.
Yes.
Okay, mm-hmm. All right. Just wanted to make sure of that. That was it.
Okay. Any comment, Ms. Pop?
No, I do. I agree with the attachment and everything that's been discussed so far. And I am not computer savvy, so I'm trying, but I'm not there.
So what's the desire here, folks?
I think, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Hale.
I think if we are looking at attaching the correspondence specific to the last meeting minutes, we ought to allow some reasonable time frame for folks. I think some of the emails referred to the feeling or fact that some people's full speeches, if you will, were included in the minutes and others weren't. We ought to allow a time frame for full speeches to be submitted.
Ms. Shadle, can you speak up a little that? Bit?
Sure.
Speak up.
Absolutely. I think if we're going to consider attaching the emails to the minutes,
okay.
There was reference in the email to how it seemed that there were some full speeches that were verbatim in our minutes and some were not.
Uh-huh.
And the, I believe the request in a couple situations, if I remember correctly, we've read an awful lot in the last week or two. If I remember correctly, the request was for the full speech to be included. We need to have that text to include it. So I don't know if our intent is to attach the emails, that is really responding to what is being requested in some cases.
My response is to stick with my suggestion to attach the emails, noting that they were received subsequently, and leave it go at that. I like the idea of the time segments, and perhaps we ought to table the approval of these minutes tonight to insert those, or maybe just do that going forward. I don't know, but that's a good idea, and I think the idea of referring to the video is a good idea as well.
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely.
So in the past, when we've approved minutes and we've made needed to make changes, we note those changes to Amy, and then we move on forward with approving those minutes, okay. and she goes back and makes those changes. And I think you've sometimes even included in our next packet.
If it's substantial, she includes it again the next month. But usually it's a typo or a word or something.
And it would be included if there was specific verbiage, it would be included in these minutes as well. It would say if you removed, if you're going to approve them, it'll say page 3, this was changed to say this. Okay. Page 5, this was changed to say this.
Let me ask the question then, for those that are wanting to utilize the emails as attachment, is that something you would see being the process going forward? Or is that this evening, and then going forward on the minutes, we would specify that this is a summary, refer to the video, here are the time links, or is that something we're saying going forward would be the process?
Well, I think we could attach the emails we've received to these minutes. Mm-hmm. I don't anticipate this is going to be a regular occurrence if we make the changes that Mr. Smith suggested. It might minimize situations like this. So I don't have a problem with attaching them to tonight's minutes and going forward making the changes that Mr. Smith, Dean Smith, suggested. Go ahead.
Oh, I just, okay, now help me out here. We talk about attaching emails. Mm-hmm. Does this mean each email is scanned and included as a PDF at the end of the meeting minutes? Does this mean that we have emails available for paper copy? What does the vision of attaching emails look like?
It's a great question.
This can go in a lot of different mm-hmm. directions.
I'm not sure I can answer the question because I don't know how the paperwork is processed. Maybe Ms. Vanson could help us, but I'm merely suggesting that the meeting minutes refer to the fact that emails were received pertaining to the minutes, and however it's physically stored is something I'm not familiar with, so I don't really know. I don't think it matters as long as it's all subject to FOIA.
Right, and that's the thing. Yeah. If everything is scanned and listed in, then it's so convenient. Bang, bang, bang.
Yeah.
But there's a time commitment that goes with that, and, of course, a cost. The other question
I don't understand something. Why is that extra cost to what we already have? We've already reproduced these emails.
We've reproduced them, but if an individual wants them, well, actually, it may be easier to scan them in.
All right.
And then have them attached as a PDF and be part of the record.
Okay.
Would we take on the minutes? And this is I don't have anything in mind right now. I'm trying to think this through.
Yeah.
So if we got an email and we PDF'd it, and would there be an index on the meetings that say on the October 25 meeting, we got 13 emails regarding our minutes, and here's the index of the emails, and then they're following in PDF form, or what might this look like? You know, it's up to us to give direction to the city planner, and I'd like to make that direction very clear.
Mr. Chair.
Okay, so here's the thing. The minutes get published, and then the comments come in. So that means automatically we have to go amend the minutes to reflect the fact that there's now an amendment. So now we've added that. There's the issue of, you know, if the minutes are correct or not, which I think was your point, in order to reflect to change the minutes to reflect them means some verification process.
Absolutely.
Which, okay, again, may or may not be, because what happens if they don't reflect them exactly?
Right.
And now we're back and forth.
Right.
And
I don't want that.
I'm not trying to put this off. I'm just trying to think practically how we manage the resources available to us to do this, and, you know, respect the information that comes into us in the comments. But I'd like to know a little bit how anybody else does this, because frankly, I just really haven't come across this very often at all. I can't think of, can you think of, I mean, you sit before a lot of planning commissions in your work.
I've never come across this situation, so I don't know how anybody
I just don't know, but I think that by simply noting in the minutes that there is a video record that is the true record, and the minutes are merely a reflection of this, all emails do get put into the record that is available for the public, you know, during normal business hours to come and review them as they come in. And also whether or not the public that submits them wants them redacted, because then we have the idea of publishing everybody's personal email address and any of the information that they have in there, which I'm pretty sure they don't want. I can honestly say mine is out there and I get a lot of email now. So just saying, it's like, be careful what's out there. I think that your solution is probably the best solution, in my opinion. So, Mr. Smith. So that's where I kind of leave it, as I think, what happens next? What happens next? What happens next?
So what do you want to do, folks?
Mr. Chair?
I'd like to make a motion to, postpone approving the minutes from the meeting in September
so Amy can go back, make the revisions that we've suggested.
Yes.
Is this an agenda item, approval of the minutes?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
So I may speak on it before you make any motions to approve or disapprove?
Yes.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, my name is Patty Curtis. I live in Kenmore. First question, are the written minutes as submitted by the official recorder the legal record, or is the video the legal record? If an attorney were to subpoena, are they provided just the hard copy of the minutes, or which one is the legal record? That's my first question. Anybody know? Okay.
Mr. Chair, but if I may answer that, my understanding is the minutes, once they are passed in the next month or two, mm-hmm. is the legal record. However, they're a summary, and I could be wrong in this, being the legal record. The actual what transpired, now that we have video, is the video. We can make that our legal record. And there's no doubt whatsoever, you know, emails come in or the summary, if there's some inconsistencies, the record is what was said on the video. We have that technology. Now, we'd have to run that by the city attorney? But
yes,
that can become.
Right. Yes, we do.
To me, that becomes our legal record is the video, because that's what happened.
Right. You're relying very heavily on that as being. Well, so before the approval, well, that's what we're getting as a group here. Although I am only speaking for myself, I have a couple of comments about this whole discussion about the approval of the minutes and the related emails. I think what is being missed here are the three major points that the citizens were making when they sent the emails. If some of the citizen comments are transcribed by the official record, the written record, nearly verbatim or very, very close to it, then everyone's should be summarized in the same fashion. If you want to only summarize, then summarize everybody's. Don't weigh them in favor of particular speakers or viewpoints. That is why you got all those emails. The minutes, as they were presented, the draft, were very heavily weighted in favor of certain opinions, and the other types of opinions appear to be glossed over. Appearance of bias. It's the appearance, it's the perception of a biased presentation as the legal record of that meeting. The second point is that people feel they were flat out misrepresented, and that needs to be addressed too. You have somebody taking the minutes who people are, they're sending you a complaint. My comments were not only not recorded, what was recorded was misrepresented. That needs to be discussed before these minutes are approved. And thirdly, not everyone has YouTube access. So if you are making a video reference in your legal document, then you have to ensure that people who don't have the money can access this, don't have the money to pay for internet service, they don't have computers, everybody's talking about seniors, not every senior has access to a computer. Mrs. Pop illustrated that perfectly by saying she's not technically savvy and that she struggles with this, as I'm paraphrasing. So that needs to be taken into consideration before you consider making the video record on YouTube and only accessible through YouTube or the city website, the record that people are supposed to refer to. And I think that's all I need to say.
Thank you. What do you want to do, folks? I don't want to go along.
Actually, it's related but a separate point. So before we rely, Lisa Kempner, before you rely too heavily on the idea that the video is the official record, should probably make sure what the retention laws are for them, because what we did 5 years ago is not what we're doing now, might not be what we do 5 years from now. So it becomes harder to say, well, this is the official, but we don't really have a great way to access it, or we destroyed it, or anything like that. So also, some people were just not included in the minutes at all. So that was one of those problems as well, like me.
Thank you. So, Mr. Chair, I know years ago, before these meetings were videotaped, they recorded them on cassettes. I remember specifically.
And that was the record.
And that was the record. So it's now moved to video. And those tapes are probably stored here at City Hall somewhere.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the retention is on it, but
yeah,
yes.
So
I don't think they're kept in perpetuity. I don't mm-hmm. think there's a legal requirement for that for these kind of records.
Wendy Zabransky. Then I wonder if the official record you're thinking that is the recording, then why do you even bother taking minutes? What are the minutes used for?
Summary.
And who uses them?
We do.
So you don't go back and look at the recording. You go by what the summary says.
Yeah.
Both.
Sometimes I'll go back and look at
it. Kind of live the recording.
Depends on what it is.
But the point is then, if the person taking minutes is not taking them correctly or bias, then there's a problem. Because that's what you're reading. That's what you're summarizing. The other thing is, I've been in many boards, and according to Robert Rules of Order, the secretary takes the minutes. I don't know why the city manager is taking the minutes. That doesn't usually how it works.
She got promoted.
She's got promoted.
My shorthand isn't good enough.
Okay, I made a motion. So.
I forgot what your motion was, Mr. Murad.
Okay, my motion was that we postpone approval of the minutes so that Amy can go back and make the changes that we talked about, and we can review.
What were those changes?
Be specific.
So,
what were those changes?
To add a link to where the video is located
on our
and on our city website, where you can go directly to it, and then also to
the timestamps.
Boy,
if I may, Ms. Vanson, can you go back to this last month with timestamps, or is that something that we want to do from now on?
I don't know.
Okay, well, and?
And then the attachments of the emails.
And? We have to talk to the city attorney about
city
some
attorney,
of these
right.
City attorney.
And city okay. attorney has to review those items.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Seconded. Ms. Franson, would you call the roll, please?
Sure. Richardson?
Yes.
Pop?
Yes.
Murad?
Yes.
Dean Smith?
Yes.
Shadle?
No.
Tangeri?
No.
Buckler?
Yes.
Martin Smith?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Takes care of that for the moment.
Oh, we're all the way to communications.
Communications tonight.
You have the DDA minutes from their October meeting.
And now we come to the citizens' comments portion of tonight's meeting. Commission members will not engage you in discussion. You may speak on a specific item, agenda item, when it becomes up for discussion. The time limit to address the commission members during public comments or in any agenda item is 3 minutes, unless special permission is to speak longer was obtained from the commission chairperson in advance of this meeting. A timer may be used to enforce the time limit. The time limit may not be extended or supplemental thought assigned of someone's else's opportunities to speak. Speakers should direct the comments to the chair, commission chairperson. Personal attacks or defamation of comments towards any one person are not permitted. Everyone is expected to conduct themselves with appropriate decorum and civility. Written statements will be accepted for the record, but will not be read aloud. If you wish to include handouts, please give them to the city planner for distribution before the start of the meeting. After public comments on a matter has concluded and the commission commences deliberations, no further public comment is permitted. Meetings shall be conducted in an orderly manner in accordance with Open Meetings Act. When an individual has completed their comments, we ask that you refrain from applause or other gestures, approval or disapproval, because this can be intimidating to some residents. When you come to the microphone, please state your name and city of residence. Yes, sir.
Kurt Height, 3525 Robina. Now, the reason why I came tonight, I wanted to take a moment and discuss what happened near the end of my comments last month. Mr. Murad mentioned that the dates for the future meetings would be shared, and I'm talking about the ones with the seniors and the high school students, would be shared with anyone concerned and would be given a chance to attend. I'm partially deaf, so I did not realize it happened until others had mentioned it to me, and then I got a chance to watch the video. I do not appreciate that either Mr. Murad or Mr. Barnett making underhanded remarks when I tell them that I may not be able to take time off of work because I work 60-plus hours. In addition to that, I have spent, since June, 20-plus hours a week and sometimes as much as 30-plus or more working on getting this amendment repealed. Okay? So you want to talk about insults? I did not appreciate that. I did not make any under comments to you while you were talking, and I answered back respectfully. So I'd appreciate it if you ask me if I want to attend and I say no, don't make an under comment about, oh, well, I'm going to make it. I can make it. You know, that's that. I did not appreciate that. And I'll accept your apology anytime you want to offer it. Okay, now, the thing is after scanning through the amendment draft, we can see that some of these meetings did, in fact, happen. We weren't told. You know, we talked in June that, when the June meeting happened for the Planning Commission, it was a pretty long meeting. And I was pretty upset that the biggest thing taken away from it was the need for more communication. So I need to ask, in the last 4 months, have there been any attempts to make the communication better? And the reason why I asked that is because the additional meetings, no attempt was made to address anybody or contact anybody to let them know that these meetings were going to happen. So if 4 months ago we knew that communication had to be better, how come no attempt was made to communicate to let us know that these meetings were going to happen? We made it clear that we were interested if these meetings were for sure going to happen. They still happened, and we didn't hear anything about it until we saw a draft for the amendment coming up for 2016. So, you know, I did have another issue that was regarding to the minutes and how they were taken. I do want to point out that the reason why I had the concerns originally is when I say that content and time spent at the mic is supposed to be reflected by the summary. When you have one resident that was on one side of an issue, talk for 10 minutes, and she has half a page of the summary, and then her whole speech included. Then you have another resident who talked for 2 minutes, and he had probably 6 or 7 sentences worth with exact figures, exact statements, almost verbatim. That's why I had the issue of when two different people talk for over 10 minutes, their speech gets combined, and it's like 3 or 4 sentences, and it did not even represent what I spoke and what I said. And I understand the need for having it as a summary. The only reason why verbatim was used is because a certain thing was said that was verbatim with facts, figures, and it did more than just represent what they said. It was exactly what they said, and it just really was very biased, and that's why I had brought up the information. I did want to bring up, I did not automatically contact somebody and say, oh, you should do this, you should do this. I asked, can you please advise me what the steps are due to correct it? And I guess I don't understand why it was so hard to just respond to me and say, you know what, currently our policy is if you send me an email with your, with what you feel you said or with your a summary, then we can include that with the minutes and get it approved. I was told, no, we don't do it verbatim. You can watch it online. And to me, I think that somebody should really go out of their way to be a little bit more helpful than that, because I had to go and look online to find out what the processes were actually, what we should expect to be able to do, whether we had a right to correct minutes or not. That information should have been provided when I sent the email, because I asked to be advised, what do I do if I felt my comments were not addressed properly. And you know, you say it goes back and forth. I guess if you do get to a point where somebody's not agreeing with, well, I said this, well, it wasn't said, I guess it could prolong. But, I mean, have there really been any more emails after a certain point? Usually what happens, according to the guidelines, the minutes are posted 8 days after the meeting. And then you're supposed to set a time frame that if anybody has a problem with those minutes, they have that long to submit something. And I would like to see that happen, because that gives a guideline. It doesn't say we're going to drag this on for 6 months. It gives a guideline to say, hey, if there's an issue with the minutes, you can make, you know, contact somebody and with the appropriate information. Thank you.
Thank you.
Lisa Kempner, Berkley, again. I'm a bit concerned with the last number of meetings. There just seems to be more rules and more rules and more rules for what citizens can say to you. I get that it's kind of been a really rough couple of months for you guys, and that you've been dealing with a lot of angry citizens, and that sucks. However, it doesn't help that every time we come in, it's like, okay, now you can't applaud. Today it's, now you can't applaud, and there's a time limit, and you can't combine minutes, even though that just happened last week. What's next? What it tells everybody is that you guys don't want us to tell you things. You don't want us to communicate. You don't want us to talk to you. I'm guessing that's not what you're trying to say. That's how it comes across. So it's very concerning to me when there keeps being more rules that have never been in place, and every week it's a new one.
Hi, how are you? My name is Gene Dixon. I own residential property in Berkley, several parcels. I think to make it easier for everyone, and sort of reading the different things here the last few months, I think words mean a lot. And I think if the intent is to keep single-family residential as single-family residential, then the word should be, it should remain as single. Any use other than single family residential is prohibited. I know a lawyer would say if you don't have the word prohibited in the statement, then it leaves the door ajar to other interpretations, other uses for the property and so forth. But if the folks here insists that the words are prohibited be in whatever is being done with the revision to the master plan. It's single family, RD1, whatever the zoning is, and anything other than that is prohibited, then you really don't have anything else, I don't think, to be concerned with, because it doesn't allow these folks to do anything other than what it says. And the word prohibited removes any doubt whatsoever. Thank you.
Barbara Morris, Berkley. I simply want to bounce off of what Kurt had said about communications. I know specifically in this meeting last month, we were promised, you promised us that we would be notified when the subsequent meetings would happen with other residents, and we would be allowed to attend those meetings. And I didn't see any notification whatsoever. I don't know what was done. And another issue I'd like to address is, as far as communications, of course, as he said, City Council said that this would happen. Communications were going to get better. And I don't see that they did. But in terms of the new amendment, I would have expected, in light of the new communications policy transparency, that citizens would have been able to view this online like immediately after it was prepared, so that we would have an opportunity to digest the information before this meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, seeing nobody else coming to the microphone, we'll end public comments this evening. Moving on to the order of business. Ms. Vanson.
Item number one is discussion on a master plan amendment related to future residential land use to include A, report from planning commissioners on meetings with senior citizens and high school students, and considering forwarding the draft recommendation for master plan amendment to the city council for review and comment.
I thought that was item
what three. Happened to item one?
Yeah.
That's item three.
You went to the good
That's
stuff.
That's three, isn't
it? I had sent you a revised agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay. We rearranged it, I'm sorry,
right,
before it was posted.
Excuse me, but I didn't get a chance to get up here to the microphone. I was coming, and you shut it off. I have one thing to say. Basically, I don't know exactly how it incorporates with all of this meeting right now, but I know that you guys are responsible to make sure building inspectors are out there where all of these construction companies are doing their constructing.
Name, sir?
Dan McLean. And I live on Royal. And I was walking at night on the sidewalks. And I twisted my ankle, basically, but I was able to keep on going and straightened it out. But the reason why I did is because right down a half a block or block, they had these construction company dump rocks and everything like that all the way out to the curb across the sidewalk, put fences, those plastic snow fences, all the way across out to the curb. And as I've been told, that's not legal in Berkeley. So if they're doing that, how come it isn't being addressed by the building inspectors? And if it's not being addressed by the building inspectors, they're allowing somebody to do something illegal. Why? That's your job to make sure, or the city's job to make sure that that's addressed. And when people get hurt walking down the sidewalk, you guys need to address that. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, what's the agenda? Because I don't have the right agenda.
Me neither.
It's item three, but it's now item one. Discussion on master plan amendment related to future residential land use.
All right.
To include the report from the planning commissioners on meetings, and then consider moving forward the draft recommendations for master plan amendment to the city council for review and comment.
Gotcha.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Martin Smith.
Can I make a motion to flip this thing back again? Let's get rid of the two little ones first. Just get them out of the way.
No, we've already approved the agenda, so let's just move back.
Yeah, we did. Okay, never mind.
All right. We've had some interesting comments from people, and you're all here tonight. And I've had some interesting comments and discussions today with Ms. Vanson twice and the city manager and Mr. Dean Smith. And what we're going to do here is we're going to take this draft amendment of 2016 and we are going to, we're not going to discuss it at all this evening. What we're going to do is we're going to defer this whole topic of the master plan amendment 216. And what we're going to do tonight is I'm going to allow Mr. Dean Smith to address the 2015 amendment.
Okay, Mr. Chair?
Sure.
I appreciate you deferring the draft that we were originally going to discuss tonight. It's certainly well written, but there's
a. Hey,
please.
Is the agenda not approved?
Yes, the agenda is approved.
But you're varying from the agenda?
No.
The agenda,
a different agenda was approved.
Okay, the agenda clearly states discussion on a master plan amendment related to future residential land use to include report from planning commissioners.
That's what we're doing. We're in the process of doing.
But you said you weren't going to discuss the master plan?
No.
I didn't understand what you said.
The master plan amendment 216 we're not discussing tonight.
This one.
That's on the agenda.
I know, but we're deferring it.
Give us a moment.
Please give us a moment.
Okay.
We're trying to explain it.
We're trying to explain what we're going to do.
Let me explain. I talk slow, so it's going to take a while. But please, just hear me out. Please hear me out.
Just listen, please.
We were just handed it when we sat down tonight. Okay?
Please.
Well, I did when I got here.
Mr. Dean Smith.
Mr. Chair, first, I want to thank you for deferring the item that we were originally going to talk to. It's well written, but there's some issues with it that would take more than tonight.
More than tonight, and more than
resolve.
A month, and more than two
yes.
months, and more than 3 months.
So what I would like to do, one of the critical things that we need to do is we need to get the issue of multiple housing or multi-residential, that's it. We need to get that off the table and make sure that everybody understands we are not pursuing multi-unit housing in the interior portions of the city. So what I've done is I went back and I pulled up the August 18, 2015 amendment to the master plan. And I read through it, and I found a few adjustments that we can make to it that will more or less clear the slate, blackboard for the younger people, and allow us to move forward with a rational discussion and one that's focused on the future of the city of Berkeley. So what I've given you guys is a two-sided sheet of paper. Now, I imagine all of you have memorized your August of 2015, so I have one copy. I can circulate it with you.
I brought mine.
Basically, what I want to do is the resolution that came with the 2015 amendment makes a couple of statements. There's a whereas, the third whereas, which for 2015, I didn't give it to you. I'm reading it to you now, and then I'll pass it around. Whereas the City of Berkeley Planning Commission wishes to encourage new apartments, two-family to four-family housing, and townhouses to provide housing near future transit stops as well as through existing neighborhoods. I would like to change that language to make it a little more specific. We have another whereas a diverse housing stock will provide quality housing opportunities to residents regardless of age, ability, or income. That is something that I would like to strike from the resolution that I'm proposing for this evening. If you go to the back of the amendment, which you don't have, but you will in a moment, there's a series of recommendations. There's a comment that essentially says residents have asked how they would be able to continue living in the city. And this is primarily seniors is the intended audience here. At the present moment, the only option is to move into an older apartment. Then we have one, two, three, the fourth paragraph, which starts out, housing styles in the Stephenson's Barber Oakland Manor subdivision and the St. John's Woods subdivision are unique. That is a paragraph that I would delete from the recommendation that I've given to you. There's another recommendation. Regulations in the remaining single and multifamily housing districts in the city should be changed to allow two-family to four-family housing and townhouses, provided certain conditions are met, such as proximity to collector streets or business districts. I propose deleting that paragraph. It's that wording is just too broad. It doesn't work for me, and I don't think it works for many people in the community. There's another, the fifth paragraph, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's actually the sixth paragraph that I'm having some trouble with, and it's because we've got an election coming next week, and we have a millage for mass transit. So I want to be very careful how we deal with that paragraph. This one, the old one, the 2015 one, reads, in accordance with the transit-oriented development, TOD, study that was adopted as part of the master plan by the Planning Commission in 2012, apartments should be permitted in single-family residential areas that are within a quarter mile of transit stops along Woodward Avenue. Now, for those of us that were on the Planning Commission in 2011, 2012, when we were talking about transit-oriented development, you may remember I lobbied pretty hard to try to get a transit stop on Woodward somewhere near Catalpa. And the idea is that if we do pass a mass transit millage, two things need to happen. First, a millage has to pass. Second, there has to be something to ride the rapid transit to other than an occasional sporting event. If we actually do have a viable downtown Detroit and a mass transit strip along Woodward, that is a game changer for the Woodward corridor. So the recommendation I'm giving to you tonight, let me pass, I got a couple more things I got to read about this, are in accordance with the transit-oriented development, TOD study, that was adopted as part of the master plan by the Planning Commission in 2012, apartments and other multifamily housing could be considered in single-family residential areas that are within a quarter mile of any newly constructed bus rapid transit stops along Woodward Avenue. Now, it's kind of ironic when Mr. Gene Dixon was up making comments. He specifically said, we need to use the word prohibited because it closes the door. I thought, oh my goodness, here's something that we may know about next week that I do not want to close the door to. So I would, on the amendment that I'm proposing tonight, the discussion with you is, do we scratch that paragraph also, or do we leave the door open in case we do have a change in mass transit here and suddenly the Woodward corridor changes? That's something for a brief discussion. But the thing is, we need to get the threat of multifamily housing in the central city out, gone. We can do that with a pretty quick overlay of the August 18th, 2015 master plan amendment. Bring that up, get it to city council, have them review it, and if it's acceptable to them, they would approve it, and multi-housing is gone. And then we can go back to having a solid, careful, thoughtful discussion about what the city of Berkley looks like 5, 10, 15, 20 years down the road. One other comment, and then I'll pass this. The best defense against redevelopment is a well-maintained single-family home. If a home is well-maintained in a good neighborhood, the economics, it'll never make sense to knock it down and put up multifamily. Good streets, good sewers, and a fully functioning public facilities. You know, one of the things we have here in Berkeley is we've got the best public works. We've got a really good city here. And because of that, we're not ripe for redevelopment throughout the city. That's it. We have three options in looking at the future. We can ignore change. Change does happen. Marty and I'll get to it, or not Marty. Ann and I will get to it when we have our comments. We met with senior citizens last night at Oxford Park Towers, and some of them remember what Berkley looked like 40 years ago, you know, as do I. It's a much better city than it was. So we can ignore change, we can prepare for it, or we can react to it. I'd like to see us as a planning commission be out in front of things so that we don't have to react to them. But this, it'll kind of give you a quick reminder of what you guys worked on while I was in the reentry process from my year in China.
What you're proposing is the changes to take the 2015, which has been in contention all this time. Which has been in contention all this time.
Yes, I'm proposing to...
And just to amend that 2015 to...
Yes, by my my language, I'm proposing to fix the 2015 amendment, take out the reference to multi-housing. My suggestion to this group is that we leave the door open for... The Woodward Corridor, if mass transit occurs. If, you know, next week the millage goes down, then it's a moot point.
Yeah, well, it might be a moot point. It might come back.
Yes, but the thought of, you know, maybe I spent too much time in sales, but I never like to close the door all the way.
Oh, I agree with you, man.
So that's what I can propose. I have a complete clean package that if you guys promise not to write on it, I'll share with you.
The reason we're doing this is in order to move things forward in a timely fashion and to put a lot of this difficulties we've experienced in the last 3-4 months behind us and to get it move on to other things, because we've got other issues here in the Planning Commission that we need to address coming up, that the City Council and our legal folks want us to address, and to continually try to put this amendment together that we were trying to do with the 2016 amendment. There's a lot of work that is left to be done on it, and it's going to take a lot longer to digest. We want to get some other input into that whole amendment thing, and so we're looking at sometime, perhaps early spring, perhaps to start looking at redrafting a new amendment. And at that point in time, we will probably break out in small groups, go into work sessions, and we're also going to look to get other feedback and information from various sources that we can muster up. This will solve the initial issue that has brought all of you here, and that is the reason that I want to move forward with what Mr. Smith has put together today.
The good Mr. Smith.
The good Mr. Smith. Mr. Dean Smith.
I hear that so many times.
And I'm happy that we might be able to move this whole thing along. Now, timeline. Let me give you some ideas of what the timelines are. If we can agree to this evening, it will move to the City Council for approval in their November, is it the 20th? Is that the date? 20th meeting. If they agree with it and approve it, then it goes out to all of the utility companies, these adjoining communities, and let's see, school district gets it. And God himself probably will get a copy of it.
Oakland County.
And they have 63 days to respond to it. Roughly. I think it's 63.
63.
63. I had it right. 63 days to respond to it. At that time, it will come back, and then we will have a meeting on it. And that puts 63 days. If we get it approved next week, it goes out in November, December, January, almost February. It'll be almost February before we see any action on it. And then we can have a public hearing. We'll have to have a public hearing on it, get public comment. And once we have all of those comments and we make any changes to it that we have to address, then we can
the Planning Commission can approve it. So that's the drift of trying to move this item forward. And that will give us an opportunity then to start from scratch on something with a new residential changes to the Planning Commission. This is a master plan. We can look at it in new light and move forward in a more in a timely fashion after the first of the year. So that's what we're trying to get through tonight, so we can get this to council and move it forward. So now, Mr. Martin Smith.
If I did my math right, so we're looking at our March meeting or April meeting that this gets resolved.
Yep.
If everything moves correctly.
Yeah, if everything moves correctly. That's if we prove it tonight.
Probably February, I think.
It could be. If I may not have done my math right, but that's assuming everything works smoothly.
It's going to be February, March, somewhere in that.
Okay, February, March instead of March,
somewhere.
April.
Yeah. Yeah.
February will be the public hearing.
Yeah.
You got another 2 weeks
March.
You have to wait and then adoption.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we may be March. Okay.
March.
End of March.
End of March, and then once it's approved, you get signed off in the next reading of the minutes. So, any more comments? Because I'm sure I'm going to get some comments out here in the audience in a minute.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, go ahead.
Good Commissioner Smith, go over your whereas again in the beginning.
Yeah. The old whereas or the new whereas?
Well,
new
your proposed revisions.
Okay, the proposed revisions.
I was on the back page looking at the recommendations, and all of a sudden I hear all these whereases, so go ahead.
Okay.
Please.
The old ones.
I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 whereases.
There's one. Well, we currently have 3, 4, 5, 6.
Yes.
Okay, go through them, please.
All right, the new whereases.
This is for the right, this just so everybody knows, this is the August 15th. Whereases.
I don't have the August 15th whereases.
Do you want the August?
That's what you're referring to, right?
He was reading the August 15th whereases.
Right. I read you the August. I read the August 15th whereases, specifically the paragraphs that I believe.
Okay, that's what I want.
Deleted.
That's what I want.
You want old or new?
Can I?
Well, I want to know what he. I'd like him to go through them again.
Can I interject here 1 second?
Okay, again, I'll go once.
Well, what I want to ask for is I want him to repeat those whereases,
mm-hmm.
and then for the ones he wants to change, I want him to read the changed one, too.
Well, okay.
I have also a question. The whereases you're reading are from the City Council's resolution?
No. What I did,
no,
okay,
it's,
understand,
it's
I went to the city website this right. morning, or actually this afternoon, and I pulled off the August 18th, 2015 amendment to the master plan.
Correct.
That's
what I have.
Under the cover of the August 18th
first page
master plan, there is a resolution that was signed off on by Chairperson Barnett,
right.
who's now Chair Barnett, and Amy Vanson, City Planner, AICP.
Okay.
What I looked through those. The idea was, all right, we have a resolution in place that has a couple of significant defects. And defect is my term, not anything else. We can clean that resolution, get multifamily off the table, and then we can proceed in a logical, orderly thinking fashion without reacting and you know trying to deal with fire.
Okay.
So
okay.
The first whereas the City of Berkley Planning Commission is authorized by Public Act 33 of 2008 to adopt a master plan for the city's development, and no change. That's your standard language. Whereas the master plan was adopted in 2007 and observed that while Berkley has a wide variety of single-family detached housing, it does not have a variety of housing types. That's fine. It's true.
That's absolutely
predominantly
true.
Detached single-family homes.
Look around. Okay.
The third whereas were the one that was the one that I have issue with, and I believe much of the community does. And this is as written for the August 18th. Whereas the City of Berkley Planning Commission wishes to encourage new apartments, two-family to four-family housing, and townhouses to provide housing near future transit stops as well as throughout existing residential neighborhoods. Now, this whereas
goes bye-bye
is the one that says, wait a minute, we want to put multi-housing everywhere in Berkeley. That it was, I don't think that's what was meant when it was done, but those are the words. Mm-hmm. So my proposed whereas that would replace that whereas. Whereas the City of Berkeley Planning Commission wishes to facilitate construction of new apartments, 2-4 family housing, and townhouses in areas currently zoned for such use. Mm-hmm. This should make it absolutely certain, absolutely clear, that we are not proposing rezoning sections of Berkeley. The fourth whereas a diverse housing stock will provide quality housing opportunities to residents regardless of age, ability, or income. That whereas, I'm proposing that we just delete. It doesn't add to the discussion and is unnecessary.
Okay, I can't disagree with that.
And the other whereases, whereas the City of Berkeley Planning Commission has notified, and the whereas the City of Berkeley Planning Commission has advertised, those whereases that I'm proposing are the same whereases as we used in August 18th, 2015.
Mm-hmm.
Does that help?
Yes, it does. It does help.
And leaving the first two in the last.
Yes, I want to leave as much of the document intact as we can,
gotcha,
so that we don't have to rewrite the whole supplement.
Got it.
Elegant.
But
okay,
it's getting multifamily out now, Mr. Richardson.
Commissioner, you had previously discussed Woodward Avenue transit corridor development. Is that still in your draft, or is that something
that's
we're going to take up?
Let's go to the other side of your two-handed, printed on the Smith Family inkjet printer handout. The recommendations from the August 18th, 2015, they stated many residents have asked how they would be able to continue living in the city
right here
if when they are no longer able to negotiate stairs or care for a single family home. All I wanted to do with that paragraph was just delete the word many and just say residents have asked.
Okay.
You know, we don't have a count in the document. I've had conversations mm-hmm. with many senior citizens mm-hmm. about what the future looks like, but it's not necessary in our recommendation. The Planning Commission wants to accommodate, you know, as people get old, which I hope to become, I'd like to be able to stay in Berkeley. And they're currently limited to the older apartment, and we'd like to see something we can do.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Can that be part of one recommendation?
It actually will become. Now, we'll go down. I have...
Okay, I interrupt. Go ahead. Keep going. I'm sorry.
The recommendation that I want to insert is one that reads, current zoning regulations permit construction of new multifamily dwellings primarily in the Greenfield District and the 12 Mile District.
That's a recommendation?
No, it's a statement,
yeah, it's a statement
of what's in the city's master plan.
Okay.
At this time, there is no need to expand multifamily zoning to other areas in the City of Berkeley. Now, that is my observation. It's consistent with conversations I've had with many people in the community. It's entirely consistent with much of the feedback we received over the last few months about the master plan amendment. Mm-hmm. I don't have any problem putting a statement that there is no current need to expand multifamily zoning to other areas other than what's along the Greenfield Corridor and the 12 Mile District. And this is, I'm looking for your feedback too. I tried to word as clean as I could, but I do have the issue with the potential improvement of mass transit along the Woodward Corridor. And that's a door that I would not like to close. Now, we have a group here, and everybody has a voice. That's a door that could be closed. Nobody dies. Okay. But to me, mass transit is the future. If the millage does pass and we do get bus rapid transit, I will push as hard as I can to get a bus stop that's convenient to anybody in Berkeley that could walk to Woodward. And that would be somewhere around the Catalpa area. If that happens, and there's a reason to ride the bus, that's where I was talking about. That becomes a game changer. And for us as a planning commission to not somehow provide consideration that an event like that could occur, I think we're selling the citizens short. But that's the discussion. So you have my position.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Richardson.
Just two comments. I agree with the desire to leave the door open with respect to Woodward Avenue development, more in intensive residential and commercial development is a benefit of the development of mass transit. So we don't want to shut that door. We worked very hard in years past to incorporate the vision of transit-oriented development along Woodward into our master plan. So we don't want to shut that door. In terms of your recommendation about including language about the need for multifamily, I'm a little uncomfortable with the word need for a couple of reasons. First, we did study this issue at considerable length prior to adopting a 2015 amendment, and we have been made aware of recommendations from the state, from SEMCOG, from other agencies about the needs for more multifamily. We also, at our last meeting, talked about the possibility of a housing assessment study. Now, I understand we don't want to delay the action on changing this language until we get that study, but I think the premise of that discussion was that we want to get more information about the needs, about the housing needs. So I think I'm a little uncomfortable to say there's no need. I think I would be comfortable saying there's no community support for allowing multifamily in existing residential areas or little community support for that. And I think it's appropriate to note community sentiment in a master plan document.
I agree almost 100% with what you said.
Okay.
Over time, I believe there will be a need for multifamily or senior housing.
Okay.
It's not today.
Do you know that, though?
Do we
know that?
Do you know that?
What I do know is that we have areas.
Information.
We have the Greenfield District that's zoned.
Yeah.
On my watch, there has been nobody proposed to build multifamily along there.
No.
So
that doesn't
completely
answer the question, though.
Well, I'm not going to go around it. I'm going to give you a direct answer.
Okay.
But I think it's coming.
All right.
But it's not today, and it may not be next week. But we have time to put together a very thoughtful update to the plan. What I would like to do is get the threat of multi-housing in the neighborhoods off the table, so that we decrease the pressure and allow us to proceed in a nice, steady, logical fashion where people aren't looking over their shoulders saying, what are those guys doing to me?
I may be perceived
and
as quibbling
those guys is us, or me
about
now,
language.
So.
I don't want to quibble, but and I don't really think I have any objection to your objective of getting that off the table. I think the mayor and the chair of this commission have both indicated on a number of occasions that should be off the table. So who are we to not take it off the table. I guess I want to be careful about drawing conclusions without, I would say, an adequate information or knowledge base.
I do hear that.
Okay. I hear that, too. And I'm, if I could, perhaps, given we don't know what's going to happen next week in a lot of this mess.
That's so, why we have pens. We can draw that out.
We can draw it out, and we can talk about it later. And my thought is here, take it out and get rid of it. And when we look at this other thing next year, wherever, we could better address it then because we'd have more thoughtful. We would know more than we know now.
Yes. Well, hopefully the clean package has made it back to you by now.
I'd just like to clean it out, be done with it.
Mr. Tangiri?
To maybe balance the two things that are being said here, would wording such as this amendment does not recommend expanding multifamily to other districts be more direct and less conclusion drawing?
I would be comfortable with that.
Yeah, there's no change in intended outcome. So
it's
whatever we want to scratch in is what we want to scratch in.
It's not assuming too much.
I wanted to come tonight prepared with something that could be signed off on so that we can get it off the table. And
exactly. That's what I want to get done.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Vermeure.
Maybe this is for Amy. So one of the whereases in here is the City of Berkley Planning Commission has advertised a public hearing in accordance with state law. So does that public hearing happen before we send this to council or after it comes back?
No. The order of things is this: the recommendations that you want to include in the 2015 rewrite, basically, would be incorporated into the plan, to the 2015 plan. I think it would make sense to show overstrikes and underlines just to make it really clear. That would go to council on November 20th. Council has the opportunity under state law to review, comment on it, and then if they think it's okay, they make a motion that it can be sent out to underlying agencies, surrounding communities in Oakland County. The resolution doesn't happen until whatever the date is for the public hearing, essentially.
All right, because I started thinking, if we had to advertise for a public hearing, we can't do this tonight.
No,
because you
have it's not time in the process, right? Right. If you look at your green sheet, I think I did them in green. It's at the bottom.
Way down the list.
Yeah. Okay.
Have you finished all the whereases and everything in the change? You finished all your changes?
As far as I'm concerned, I finished the changes at 6:42 this evening.
Now, anybody else want to, what do you want to weigh in on this?
Well, I had a few notes, too.
Oh, you're got the floor.
But actually, they pretty much reflect what the good Mr. Smith said. What about, we have the third recommendation. It's really a non-thing. There's no desire to change prohibition of parking on streets between 2 and 6 a.m. Any new housing developments would need to accommodate sufficient parking on the site. Is that intended to be removed?
No, I had no intention of removing
it. Okay, well,
that.
I didn't hear it from you, and that's why I wanted to know. And any code change, the last one, number 7, I numbered these myself, should require that new buildings are appropriate to scale and style so they fit in the neighborhood. I mean, that's obvious. We've been saying that all along. So I wouldn't want to strike that either.
That's in there, too.
I know it is. Okay.
Yeah, I have six recommendations.
You deleted Oakland Manor and St. John's Woods.
That was...
That's not in
that was in the whereas.
That's in the whereas.
No, it was in recommendations.
That's in recommendations.
Well, it's in the old recommendations.
It's in the old recommendations. So you're deleting that.
Oh, it came back.
You changed one whereas, you deleted one.
Okay, recommendations. Yes, I did.
Okay, I have delete question mark on that. I assume we want to delete it. I mean,
I thought so.
Yes, that's I do want to delete that. Okay. Somehow this reappeared and I didn't even know it came back.
They do that.
So I wanted to insert the one about the current zoning regulations permit in the Greenfield District and the 12-mile District. And then what I'm hearing is that when this finally does, well, this is what we'd be doing tonight, we would strike out the statement
fourth?
That at this time there is no need to expand multifamily zoning to other areas in the city of Berkeley. Or we would replace it with some other wording. There was
I heard some other wording.
Between
this amendment does not recommend expanding multifamily.
Okay.
Or it could say no desire to, just like the preceding paragraph says no desire to.
No current desire, yeah, at this
no
time.
Current no, current desire.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that was even better. There
instead
is no
of need, desire. No current desire.
Yeah.
Current desire.
Mm-hmm.
That's like efficient.
Yeah. Okay. But other than that, I had a lot of red on here, and I pretty much agreed with the, you know, and we didn't even talk about this. It must be both being Smith. I don't know.
Collective IQ running into double figures.
You got it. We've said that before about ourselves. Okay. Now, I do have a underlined a quarter mile of transit stops regarding the transit or oriented development.
I was
not talking about the 2016, but that's at a half mile. Was one of these a typo?
2012, they had a couple of different, the TOD that was developed for South Oakland County communities, and we adopted it by reference.
It's just that in one document it says a quarter, the other document says a half.
Well, it says two different, it says a quarter for some things and a half for others.
Okay, then I read through it too fast.
So
I think a half is like a measurement of walkability.
Well, absolutely.
And
right.
A
absolutely.
Quarter is, I think, probably reflective of the size and scale of Berkeley and what would be appropriate coming off the Woodward Corridor.
I just I just want to make sure quarter. I like the quarter mile.
What the TOD study says is it recommends allowing the highest commercial intensities within a quarter mile of locations that are most suitable for transit, and then consider increased residential densities within a half mile from the station.
Okay, but that's not what these recommendations say from 2005.
I copied them directly off the August 2015 update.
I have it, the 2015 here. And this says single family residential areas that are within a quarter mile. Now, I like that verbiage better.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Then half mile.
And I just for half kicks today, I kind of rolled my bicycle up and down Woodward.
A quarter mile.
You know, a quarter mile each way from Catalpa. And there's things that potentially could change in a positive way.
And they could put the transit station at 11 mile, too.
There's been a lot of talk about it at 11 mile instead of Catalpa.
Yeah, and if a transit station goes in at 11 mile, then that certainly changes my view of what this would look like.
No. Mm-hmm.
And that's why you want to have some flexibility.
I think the quarter's fine the way it's written.
I think quarter's fine,
absolutely.
Too.
Mm-hmm. And that's
that
why.
Makes the scale of
quarter
is
right. Just fine and dandy, I think.
Yeah. So anyway, I had a lot of the same notes you did, so I just wanted to be clarified. So, in general, the new one, I like the word desire instead of need, but that's a word.
Mm-hmm. It does read better.
Sure. Now, what about something came up earlier about about maintenance of housing, and I forget what the context was, but I heard the statement, the best way. And what?
I wrote all kinds of random notes as I was preparing it. And one of the things that came to mind was, you know, we talk about the threat of redevelopment. Well, the best defense against any area being redeveloped is well-maintained housing in a well-maintained community.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a community with good streets, good sewers, the public works buildings are all good. That all adds to the value of the community.
And the private residences.
Once they start to get run down, then you move into a disinvestment mode.
Right.
And that's when it becomes ripe for redevelopment. Today in Berkeley, I don't see areas that are ripe for redevelopment. Housing values are too high. And I kind of like it that way.
There's lots that are ripe for redevelopment. There those are happening.
Yes.
Right.
So those are individual lots.
That's what I just said. Yeah, lots are happening.
Not whole sections.
But not pockets.
No, there's not pockets where you're going to tear down 20 or 30.
That's why I said.
That's where that note came from. I have.
I didn't know if that was going to be one of your recommendations or not. So that's part of the ramblings.
My rambling too.
Thank you.
All right. Yes.
Stephanie Height, HEIDT, Princeton. Within the quarter mile of Woodward. So that would be my question to you is, what happens if this transportation line does come through? At what point will you guys put multifamily back on, where I'm now going to start fighting for my property again?
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Dean Smith?
I live on Larkmore. I'm also close to Woodward Avenue.
Okay.
So my thought is, if this thing does happen, which odds are against it, but I want to be optimistic, it becomes a game changer. And now all of a sudden, maybe not into our neighborhoods, maybe not way off Woodward, but some of the buildings, and I was snickering, there's a building on Woodward, south of Catalpa, that I would love to see converted to a place where people live instead of eat. But the market changes. If you have a mass transit stop, everything's up. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got, across Woodward, there's an auto parts store and a paint store. Well, the economics are such that if there's a bus or a high-speed, rapid transit stop right there, that's worth more as a residential building than it is as an auto parts store. Mm-hmm. So that could change. On the Berkley side, you have the same thing. We go north of Catalpa on the Berkley side. There's some, I wouldn't call them marginal, but there's some properties that would probably find a higher use. Mm-hmm. What I want to do is not close the door to a potential redevelopment, but understand in no way, shape, or form does the city of Berkley come knock on your door and say, hey, we're taking your house away. Somebody has to come to you with a big wad of this green stuff they call money and convince you to take your house away. So there's not this taking of property. It's just a potential that if the economics were right, somebody might want to do that. And I don't see that as being bad.
If I might add, planning process I'm familiar with, I think even if it goes through as scheduled, won't.
20 years out.
Yeah, it's a 20-year plan, and the Woodward corridor is not the first link that's scheduled to be developed. I think we're looking at least 10 years before bus rapid transit arrives at Woodward, if it ever does. So that's one reason we're not proposing any changes along there right now, because we don't know what's going to happen. But as Commissioner Smith said, we have to be responsive if there are changes.
So that was going to be my next question, would be, with the proposed changes that you have right now, you're going to be removing some things, which I applaud you. I think that's absolutely wonderful, and I thank you for that. But the multi-housing won't come back unless rapid transit is seen coming through Berkley.
Well,
is that correct?
It's not even...
Not like that.
No, it's not. That's a little too cut and dried, I think.
It's well, the intention is, at least from my perspective, if you have a game changer, such as bus rapid transit, occur, I would want to leave the possibility open that we would consider rezoning those areas. And that at that time, you've got the whole process we're going through now. There's lots of participation. There's the ability for the entire community to manage the process. Mm-hmm. But I just want to see us be out in front of it rather than chasing behind it.
Okay. I just wanted some clarification on that. So.
Does that help?
Yes, it does.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
Well, I think they answered the question. I mean, it wouldn't be, again, a wholesale the city going and rezoning something. It would be considering requests as they came forward,
right,
and only from property owners. So they'd have to, you know, it's you can't speculatively change zoning on something that you don't own.
Right.
And so it would be, you know, somebody acquiring the property, and then we would consider it. But I think it's clear we don't rezone everything that comes to our doorstep.
That's right.
That's right.
Right.
And if they
I
think it's important to note that, you know, the RTA, they're looking at linkages first, and then in order to get a rapid bus line, this is a massive reconstruction that, you know, the funds are going to have to come partially. This millage is going to fund these linkages and establishment of routes and whatnot. But to get the infrastructure necessary to run it all the way up Woodward, I mean, look at how long it's taken just for the M1. It's going to take a long time. It isn't happening tomorrow or even 10 years. I would think we wouldn't see shovels in ground for a very long time. And then there's still a lot of negotiation between the communities, because we've put our wish list out there of how we'd like it to see, but it all has to flow together from the Birmingham model to the Ferndale model to the Pontiac model and up and down. So there's an awful lot on the table. So.
Yes, sir.
My name is Lewis Bishop, 1404 Eaton Road. The part about all of this that bothers me is again the quarter mile thing, and quarter mile into off of Woodward, to my calculation, would put it at about Cass Avenue. So then, is the intent that anything that from Cass Avenue to Woodward would be open to this kind of development? That's the way that I'm seeing it.
Great question. It's a radius.
It's a radius.
Yeah.
It's a radius.
Right.
It's a radius from a spot.
From wherever and, the transit stop
yeah,
would be.
And our section of the city is vulnerable to that, whereas north of Catalpa, it's not, because that's the privileged zone of Berkley and can't be changed. So, you know, so it does bother me. It's like if I'm a developer or whatever, I'm going to push for a transit thing, let's say, right in the middle of between Catalpa and 11 Mile.
Well, the problem is there won't be the developer who will make the decision on where the transit stop's going to go.
Well, not developers. It's MDOT.
It's going to be MDOT and
RTA.
They're the ones that are going to make it where it is most convenient and where they figure they're going to get the most ridership picked up.
MDOT is a state road.
And that's it. Please. And that's who's going to make the decision. It won't be developers.
Mr. Chair? I would like to believe that, but having been around for a long time, I know how politics works, and there's a lot of things that can be done to sway those decisions. So I would rather see the language rather than a quarter of a mile. I would rather see something that was like maybe immediately adjacent to the Woodward corridor or something like that, where it would rule out a lot of the residential areas that are further in off of Woodward. So that would be my suggestion.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Muir.
And if that transit stop is at Catalpa, that quarter mile radius would go north of Catalpa too. So.
Mm-hmm. I don't think it's going there.
Yeah, but again, it's also, we don't know this.
No, we don't know.
Right? No, we don't.
In 2 weeks after the election,
we won't know it either.
If the millage doesn't pass, then they're back to square one. They got to start all over, and it's a moot point.
Mr. Dean Smith, what do you think about that idea of adjacency to Woodward?
I'm entirely content with adjacency. The whole idea is just I don't want to close that door.
I understand.
And other than that, you know, if it's next to, above, below, adjacent is nice because it's a flexible word, and you don't have the, but we talked about the quarter mile, and that's how far people walk.
Yeah, I know.
Ideally, something would happen close, and if the world changes, it spills out. Adjacent is fine with me.
I'd go adjacent.
And the way this is worded, the only way those areas could be rezoned is if the RTA passes and they build the transit.
Yes, that was my intention, was to make it very clear that if there's the game changer, like the mass transit or rapid mass transit, that would be a triggering event.
Okay.
Hi. I'm a bit confused. So the amendment in July, we all realized the amendment was a big problem and we were going to rewrite it. The city attorney said you can't just amend an amendment. It has to go through this whole process. You have to rewrite it. And you guys said we have to rewrite it. And now here we are in November, and you're like, eh, we're just going to change a couple words and throw it out there.
No, we're rewriting.
We're rewriting. We're in essence changing a couple words. This could have been done months ago. But there was all of this, we can't do that. It's more complicated than that. It's not that simple. And now in November, you've changed a couple words and crossed out a couple lines. Then why couldn't we have done this in August?
Thank you.
Thank you.
No answer.
Well, they're in a hurry to go deer hunting, so that's why they're done.
World Series, to be clear.
World Series.
I happen to have been involved in mass transit. I was a driver for transportation facilities up north, so I know a little bit about what you guys are talking about. I'm asking you why it has to be rapid or mass transit. When you're talking about a lot of seniors, what we had to do is they call and they ask for a bus to come and get them and take them somewhere. So why do you have to have it be so that you have to have, that we did have a couple bus stops, but only a couple. And then when they had a facility or a thing going on, like the Amish have an auction that takes place. So they have like three stops that the buses go around and pick up people for that auction. Why can't you do something like that? And then that way, the people that need the transportation to go to their doctor's appointments or something like that can have something like that for Berkley. There's going to be, like some of you said, quite a few senior citizens. And I'm really going to be one of them because on Sunday I'm going to be 70. So
happy birthday.
Anyway.
Happy birthday. I'm still.
Thank you.
Well, I wish you a happy birthday. One of the things about transportation, the only reason we're talking about this piece is because there's this proposal for this mass transit down Woodward Avenue, and it's going to go down some other corridors also in Agrashit and Went, Michigan, I don't know, all over. And I understand your thing. I know we do have senior, mm-hmm. we do have bus service for senior transportation for senior citizens. They can arrange that through the community center, I believe. And so there is. Will that be expanded in all of this talk of this new transportation? That's up for grabs, too. So there may be additional services coming. We have to wait and see. Well, but we do have it right now. We do have services for seniors.
Well, I'm glad to hear that because I'm sort of not really familiar with this. I happen to be down here basically because I now have a significant other that I didn't have a year ago.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Hey.
Good things all around.
That's all this talk about getting old.
So anyway, but yes, there is availability, and I believe they can find it on the website, or they can call the community center.
Recreation Center.
Yeah,
yep. Can you publish
department.
That?
It's
through the Recreation Center.
Yeah.
Oh. If you have a senior center,
yeah.
Yes. Publish it there, Park. Please.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Center.
I think it's in the Berkley Buzz.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I have a few questions. Well, as far as the transportation issue goes, it's going to be decided next week. I don't think we should hold anything up for that.
We're not.
You.
We're not.
We want to make our decision
okay, well,
on this tonight.
All right, let me back up for just a second. Instead of interrupting me, let me finish.
Go ahead.
First of all, my question, first question is, the 2016 draft amendment that was in the packet tonight, is that like to be destroyed? Is that garbage, or is that a starting point for the next one?
It'll most likely be a starting point for the next one, whatever. It'll be a starting point. We'll use it as a starting point, but I imagine it'll go through quite a mess of changes and what have you, and additions and subtractions and what have you. But I don't know until we get to that stage of the game, and that's going to be, I'm not sure when we're going to start it, sometime next year. Sometime later in 2017, sometime. But we'll let you know when we start it, and then we'll go
from there. Is that a promise? Is that
yes,
a real promise?
A real promise. Real promise. We'll let you know.
Can you use e-blast to let us know? I mean, because I don't know how we were supposed to know about it before.
What can we do, Ms. Vanson, when we...
I'll check with the city manager's office.
We'll check with the city
it's
manager,
up to them when
and we'll
they
let
send
you know.
E-blasts.
It's so. On the published agenda, though.
So, okay.
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Medine. Sir.
Just to clarify, the e-blast is the one that comes out that says there's a water main break on Buckingham and, you know, stay tuned? Mm-hmm. Or mm-hmm. is that an e-blast?
Right, and that's sent through the city manager's office.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Now I know.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Next.
So the transportation issue that you're discussing right now, in my mind, I don't understand why it is even an issue to worry about, because even if it passes next week, as you pointed out, it's going to take decades before it ever is affected.
That's true.
So you're going to discuss a new amendment not too far down the road, and because we're talking 10, 20 years out, why should that be an issue to hold up anything right now? Why? I mean, obviously some people are
we're not going to hold it up. Just we're going to try to move it along here.
I think the can I ask a question?
Sure.
You? Okay. So there's kind of two things that happened. One, we had a draft 2016 amendment that got deferred because at a late hour, Mr. Smith had a, I think, rather elegant idea, which was to address the primary concerns, which there's more than one concern, but the primary concern from the public seems to be the threat of potential multi-residential development inside the city neighborhoods instead of keeping it at the fringes. So the amendment process is generally lengthy because this is a full room of voices, and they're probably fairly singularly in unison on what the cases may be. But the amendment process will be open to all, so there can be a lot of conflicting voices, and we'll have to sort them out. So that can delay the process. So in the meantime, the process that Mr. Smith has recommended, which is changing some of the language in the 2015, which is still an amendment, but it's a kind of a quicker path towards an amendment because there's many things in there that are of no consequence, like that we publicize and blah, blah, blah. But there's some language changes in there that pull that threat, for lack of a better term, multi-residential development or rezoning off the table, and then allow us to address the, you know, the larger part of the master plan at a more, let's call it, leisurely pace, because some of our meetings have a lot of site plan review or they have other things that come up that need to be addressed, so there isn't always time to talk about the master plan. I think the last amendment from 2015 probably took the better part of a year, year and a half, and it was slotted in as time allotted during these meetings when, like, we didn't have any site plans or any giant things to talk about, so we don't have five-hour meetings every week. So that's, I think, the prongs of what's going on. So it still has to, the plan that brought forth the change in the resolution and recommendations by good Mr. Smith still has to go through a process. And that process timeline will still take it into March, give or take, to get finally approved. That is much quicker than what we see before us in this draft 2016, which could take us much longer because there's a lot more points to deal with. And there is, by the time we probably get to it, a complete rewrite of the master plan, because it has to be reviewed every 10 years anyway. So I think, you know, so we may do a master one, but, you know, the idea of the transit, his concern was he didn't want to put a word prohibited in there, because there may or may not be something that comes up that may make us review or reevaluate how we deal with that part of Berkley and how you all deal with that part of Berkley. We don't know what's going to happen. So that was just merely, he was just making his point that he wanted to leave that door open, and I think it is of little consequence at the moment, because you're right, it could be 10 years down the road, so it's nobody's going to be threatening to redevelop in that area tomorrow. And again, you can only ask for rezoning of property that you own.
All right.
And so if nobody's selling it, and even if they do sell it, it doesn't mean it gets rezoned. It's clear and over on, is that Eaton? No, that's Oxford.
Oxford.
So I think we're, in order to address, again, the primary concern of what we've heard, which is nobody wants to see residential or multi-residential redevelopment in the city center blocks. I mean, they want to keep it on the fringe. I think Mr. Smith's proposal is a good one, and gets it done as that point as quickly as possible. It does not address some of the other, what we consider structural issues of the master plan that need to be fixed, but those can be done, as Chair Barnett said, at a more thoughtful and deliberate pace.
Yep.
But if the primary concern is we want this threat of rezoning outside of these, you know, off the table, then this is the path that gets you there the quickest.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I understand all that. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty clear on that.
Did I answer your question?
No.
Okay.
No, I like your plan. I like your proposal. I think it's a good one. My suggestion that I'm trying to make is that there is concern about it being in the neighborhoods. The language that you're discussing is a quarter mile or half a mile, quarter mile within, that would extend into the neighborhoods. And there's obviously the gentleman before me spoke to that. And I'm just suggesting, why does that need to be something that it remains a concern for residents when we all know that the possibility of rapid transit being effectuated is far down the road? I mean, let's face it, it is down the road. Whether it's approved or not approved, it's still going to be down the road. And you are already discussing a new amendment to follow this amendment, which you can reopen the door to it or do whatever you choose to do. But in order to, you know, get the process moving and get that off the table, what's the problem?
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Dean Smith?
I think the most direct answer is, I don't like to surprise people.
It's
just not what you do. So,
can I just say something? I would just like to point out that Mr. Smith was not on the board when they created this last amendment, so he wasn't party to that.
I'm on the Planning Commission. I wanted to make it abundantly clear to anybody that would read this that there's a potential game changer out there, and I think it would be wrong to close the door on it. That's all. It says consider. It doesn't say change. I wanted to make the wording soft enough so that there's an awareness that if this thing happens, and my money says it won't happen, but if it does happen, we have a responsibility to consider it.
Okay. Does it need to be a quarter mile into the neighborhood?
We've been talking tonight. We've now come up with a word called adjacent. Okay. I want there to be an awareness that if this happens, that may change the game. Okay. Whether it's a quarter mile adjacent, that's, I think, semantics is the word. It's the idea there's a concept. There's something out there. Let's keep an eye on it.
Mr. Mayor,
Mr. Smith, let me ask you a question. So this item still leaves the possibility of multifamily in residential and single-family residential areas. So we are going to do our due diligence after we make this change.
So couldn't we put this back in later on if the millage passes?
You could. I would have
so
no objection to that.
We could strike that completely now.
This is something that is it's big enough. It's like that elephant coming down the street.
I understand what you
and
say.
And if it's
I
out, it doesn't
if,
damage
if it's
anything.
If make the residents more comfortable with it not being there, I have no problem taking it out.
Okay, but in 20 years, when I'm 80, when this happens...
But we can, when we do our additional studying, and come, and we could, and maybe the millage passes, then we can reintroduce it back in at a later date.
Yeah, I would have no objection to that at all.
So then I think we should strike that.
And I think
agree.
That's what you're asking.
Well, I'm just posing the question. I agree. I don't like that it initially put it into the neighborhood. I understand the accommodation that you're trying to make. But I don't want other people, I don't want the residents to be uncomfortable with what you're doing tonight. Now, there's processes down the road that you're going to rile everybody up again over. I'm quite sure of that. But in the meantime, I think it would be a good faith effort.
To delete it?
To a deleted or, well, to a... Okay, delete it.
That works, as long as everybody understands this is something that could happen.
Mm-hmm. I think we do. We're voting on it next week. I'm pretty sure everybody knows about it. Okay, I do have another issue, and it's not directly related to what you're talking about, but it is the agenda item. I don't know if I can mention it at this point, and that's the meetings that you had with other community members recently, apparently. I'm not really clear on what took place or when it took place with the seniors and teenagers. May I ask about that?
I'd like to put this aside if I could, and then we'll talk about that maybe in our comments as we go through the evening. We'll set that aside for the moment. I want to get through this so I can move on. So okay. We'll talk about that.
I'll be glad to wait. Thank you.
Thank you.
Joshua Hunter, I live in Thomas. Just wanted to jump off the point Commissioner Murad said. He made the point I wanted to make that the master plan, I think, is very flexible. It's responsive to changes. So I think it'd be a great, it'd send a great message, restore trust in the community if that multifamily language, including the quarter mile from the transit stop, was just removed. And if this millage passes and residents decide, hey, this is a good idea, this should be part of our plan for the future, then it could be amended again. But I think at this point, it should just be struck from the previous amendment. Thank you.
All right. Okay.
Hi, my name is Lori Robertson. I live on Dorothea. I would like to see, instead of using the word multifamily or alternative housing or higher density, I would like us to focus on senior housing. I think that you could do a multifamily complex, but if it was specific for seniors, which is what our community really needs, I think that everybody would be receptive to that. I would hope so anyway. So I think if we focus more on senior complexes, and we all know that multifamily also means higher density. We know that it means alternative housing. So changing the word really isn't the solution. I think we need to focus more on the seniors.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Can we move then? What is the desire of the Planning Commission at this point?
Mr. Chair?
Dean Smith.
Discombobulated again. You should have in front of you a clean copy of
recommendations.
My recommendations. My recommendation regarding the recommendations is the fourth paragraph, which begins with current zoning regulations. Mm-hmm. If you would, on your copy, which is the one I'm thinking you're going to be initialing, is at this time there is no, scratch out the word need and insert current desire. to expand multifamily zoning to other areas in the city of Berkeley.
I would argue the word current isn't really.
Where am I at now?
Right here.
You're in recommendations.
Got it. I got it.
Okay. Fourth paragraph down, current zoning, and then Mr. Tangeri just said there you could delete. Yeah, current desire, because at this time, current, that would be a duplicate redundant.
Okay.
So at this time, there is no desire to expand multiple family rezoning.
Got it.
The paragraph below that, the one that I absolutely love, I guess that would be deleted.
Okay.
I liked it too.
So we have 5 paragraphs under recommendations.
Okay.
And then a draft of the resolution that you would use 3 months down the road when this goes to council.
All right. Okay. This is your motion, right?
This is my motion.
Is there a second to the
motion? I'll support it.
Supported by Commissioner Murat. Any more discussion on this? All right, let's have a roll call.
Looking at this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this says nothing. There's nothing here anymore.
What it does is it deletes reference.
I know it does.
To.
I know it does.
That's my goal here.
Okay.
Is to.
I like the. I like your like the fourth or fifth paragraph with the TOD, but if it's the desire of the, you know, we didn't go around. Sometimes we do a straw poll, whether we want that included or not. In good faith, let's delete it. I don't have a problem with that, but I'd like to know if people up here really want that removed or not.
All right.
We don't want to. I like it in there.
Let's go around the table.
All right, you want it in.
I'd like to keep it in there with the amendment, with the adjustments that we talked about.
Mr. Richardson.
Well, we...
The
we
mass transit needed, one.
Pardon?
Sorry.
It's a mass transit.
We deleted the words quarter mile and changed it to adjacent.
And?
And with that change, I was comfortable with this paragraph. Mm-hmm. And I would have no problem voting for this with that paragraph in there. It's my intention, though, to vote for the motion that's currently on the floor. I would also note that I think that in other parts of our master plan, we have references to transit-oriented development. One point I'd like to make, it was more or less sarcastically asserted that we could have done this in August. The intent was to do this clean, to scrap this amendment and substitute a new amendment. What I'm hearing from the chair is that that's not possible to do it clean because of time constraints. We have other important matters that are pending that are going to come before us. It would stretch out the process of scrapping this and substituting something a long time. So it's been the expressed desire of the citizenry to get this done. And I think Mr. Smith's motion is responsive to that. Believe it or not, sometimes we have to change our strategy and tactics to meet current circumstances. So let's all try to be realistic about this. And one other thing too, the planning process will never end. That's the nature of the beast. In for a dime, in for a dollar. You know, you either want to follow this for years or you want to walk away. But you can't expect things to just be put to rest because it just doesn't work that way. It's just not the way the world is, the planning world is. I think we have to be real about that. That's all I have to say.
Maddie?
I think the paragraph should stay. Changing the word quarter mile to adjacent works.
Mr. Murad?
I feel it should stay in, but I know that the residents are uncomfortable with it, so I'm fine with it going.
Ms. Shadle.
I have no issue with it going, knowing that the transit's a game changer. So, you know, I suspect it may or will come back in the future, but I have no issues.
Ms. Buckley.
I think it should stay in with the caveat that we would change the quarter mile to adjacent, because I do think that should be recognized that the transit-oriented development, because something's going to happen even without the RTA. I mean, there's going to be just increased traffic up and down there. So whether we have a formal rapid bus system or just an improved smart system, something's going to happen.
Mr. Tangiri.
I think we can safely drop it, and that would give us a chance to address it in more detail in the future.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Dean Smith.
I think it's not worth a fight.
Okay.
But I have this feeling that deletion of this paragraph, sometime down the road, somebody who's looking to site a station is going to say, well, you clowns in Berkley, you don't want it. So why do you want it now? So the downside is you send the wrong signal. Mm-hmm. And that's a choice people make.
So what do we got? What do we got?
Tie.
Tie? It's up to me.
Mm-hmm. That it is.
Oh, thank you for putting me in that fix, people. Because I'm torn between both, to be honest with you.
I am too.
I'm torn between both of them. But I think I like your idea, Mr. Smith, that taking it out sort of sends the wrong message to some folks in the RTA and that development. So
we can change the language.
We can always change it when we get into a new amendment or whatever. So there. I think we should leave it in.
So does that mean that my motion has to be remade?
Yeah. Well, you just need to adjust it.
Okay. So I would.
You're gonna please.
You should probably vote on it since it was already supported.
Okay. All right. So then we would vote and then perhaps.
Yeah.
Turn down.
Right.
The motion that was made and then make another motion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess that's what you want to do. Yeah.
The amendment to the motion.
Or you could do that. You could. Amend the motion.
You can amend your motion.
Okay.
You want to amend your motion?
All right. I, at the request of my fellow planning commissioners, to amend my motion to include 1, 2, 3, 4, the fifth paragraph as considered in single-family residential areas that are adjacent to any newly constructed bus rapid transit stops along Woodward. My adjustment would be to leave that paragraph in the recommendations.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Discussion?
Discussion.
So by leaving it in, it really doesn't impact anything because this doesn't, nothing can happen to the residential areas until the RTA passes and the transit stop is determined.
This is something mechanical that just sends a signal to the authorities for the busing that says Berkley is open to being considered for a rapid transit stop.
Yeah. That's the only reason.
That's what long-range planning is all about.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, absolutely. You leave the doors open in this case. And it does nothing if, a stop isn't developed, and most likely
nothing
it
ever
won't.
Happens, right?
And if it does, it's going to be a generation from now. So
it's only adjacent.
You're right. It sends the message, and that's why I brought this up.
Okay.
No, I agree.
Okay. All right.
So I support his amendment.
You support it.
Oh. Yes.
So we got more than. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, I don't mean to drag this out. My name is Kayla Mile. I live on Bacon, and forgive me, I'm not very familiar with the other amendments, but if you're worried about the RTA not knowing that you want a transit stop, isn't there already a transit amendment? Like, there's a whole separate amendment dedicated to the transit, isn't there? Yeah. So I think that alone would hopefully let the, you know, RTA know you guys are potentially serious about that. So I don't know. If that's even a concern, or maybe the amendment isn't about the RTA, it's about something else. I honestly don't know. And if it is, I apologize.
Okay.
But
thank
just
you.
Want my 2 cents. Thank you.
Thank you.
There
Joshua Hunter. I'm just trying to understand what motion was made. Is it? It was the. Can you reread the? Sure. Has the motion been? Motion has been voted on. Yeah, I just heard a second.
We're still discussing.
We're in discussion.
Okay.
You want me to read it?
Yes.
So the first motion was made to recommend this plan to City Council. It's a 2015 plan. It's an amendment to that. And I would have all of these, it would say, recommendations. Residents have asked how they would be able to continue living in the city if when they are no longer able to negotiate stairs or care for a single family home. At the present moment, the only option is to move into an older apartment. The Planning Commission wants to accommodate this population cohort to ensure that such housing types are of equally high quality to the single family houses currently being constructed. There is no desire to change the prohibition of parking on the street between the hours of 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. Any new housing developments would need to accommodate sufficient parking on the site. Current zoning regulations permit construction of new multifamily dwellings, primarily in the Greenfield District and the 12 Mile District. At this time, there is no desire to expand multifamily zoning, to other areas in the city of Berkeley. And then the original motion deleted a paragraph, which I'll include in a minute with the amendment. Any code changes should require that new buildings are of an appropriate scale and style so that they fit into the neighborhood. Appropriate outdoor space and parking should also be required. So that was supported by Mr. Murad. There was discussion with regard to the TOD. The paragraph, so then Mr. Smith, Dean Smith, made a motion to amend his original motion to include this paragraph in addition to what I just read. In accordance with the transit-oriented development study that was adopted as part of the master plan by the Planning Commission in 2012, apartments and other multifamily housing could be considered in single-family residential areas that are adjacent to any newly constructed bus rapid transit stops along Woodward Avenue. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that was also supported by Mr. Murad. So what they're going to vote on first is whether to include that paragraph, that transit-oriented development that I just read. And then, depending upon how that motion, that vote goes, then there's the main motion of what I read.
Okay.
First.
Now I have a question regarding zoning on Woodward. Is multifamily development allowed on Woodward already?
If it's above a first-story business use, yes.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Okay.
Ms. Vance, I thought with the amendment, we had one motion on the floor to vote on.
No. You have an amendment, and then you have the main
motion. What was the purpose of the amendment?
Well, we amended. We're talking about amending the amendment.
So when we vote.
Amending the motion. I'm sorry.
Well, when we vote, we're going to be voting for the second one with the paragraph in. If
that's
that
what
fails,
I thought.
Then we go back to the other one and vote for that.
Well, you're really just voting. You're voting on the paragraph that says TOD. Do you want that in or not? Yay or nay? That's going to be your
just,
first one.
Just the way
voting
you put it.
Voting on the amendment first, and then we vote on the final motion.
Right. Whether it, yes. Okay.
So a yes vote would be to keep the paragraph or to delete the paragraph?
On this one, yes. A yes vote is to keep the paragraph with the word adjacent rather than as I read it.
Call the roll.
Okay. Martin Smith.
Yes.
Richardson.
Yes.
Pop.
Yes.
Murad.
Yes.
Dean Smith.
Yes.
Tangeri.
No.
Buckler.
Yes.
Shadle.
No.
Barnett.
Yes.
Okay. So motion carries that the TOD study, as I read it, with areas adjacent to Woodward bus transit, bus rapid transit stops along Woodward, is then part of the recommendation on the main motion that would go to council. Okay. You ready?
Go.
Okay. Dean Smith.
Yes.
Tangeri.
Yes.
Shadle?
Yes.
Buckler?
Yes.
Murad?
Yes.
Pop?
Yes.
Richardson?
Yes.
Martin Smith?
Yes.
Barnett?
Yes.
All right, let's get to the little stuff.
I need to
get home by 10:30.
Okay.
Good work, Commissioner Smith.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean Smith. Thank you to all the residents.
for your input, and hopefully we'll start moving this thing to a good conclusion and move on. Let's move on to whatever the next item is.
Were you going to let folks know about how the meetings went with the residents? Pardon?
Let's talk about that.
Yeah, okay, let's talk about those meetings. Both Mr. Smith and I met with the community center to talk to the group of seniors that were there that day. There happened to be about 8 people. It was not a good sampling of the city's senior citizens.
Apparently Euchre Day isn't the day to show up.
No, Euchre was more important to them than so. The input we got was very sketchy. There was one lady there from Detroit. She lived in Detroit, but she comes to Berkeley and participates in their club. We did talk to one gentleman who is a senior citizen, and he is concerned right now about living in Berkeley. He's living in Berkeley now. His wife, I think, passed away 2 years ago or a year ago. And his concerns were that there's no place really for him to go, or for him to go when he's finally can no longer support the home, and he would be more than likely have to move out of the community, somewhere out of the community. So he was a little bit concerned about that. There was another
you
lady.
You need to speak up. The mic's just died.
Mic went out. My microphone just died.
Yep.
Hello, test.
There you go.
Did you get it? There were a couple other comments, and
there were several comments, and one I thought was pretty interesting. I think Commissioner Martin Smith, who's also the other good Smith.
Yeah.
We also went to the open house that Huntington Woods had.
Yes, that's
true. And Huntington Woods, being pretty much built out like Berkeley, has many of the same issues. They're getting older, and there's no place for people to go. The guy at the senior center that really impressed me was, he was, well, hey, you know, all I got to do is move to Royal Oak. And so, that was kind of an eye-opener to hear from others that we think of Berkeley as being Berkeley, but we're also part of a larger community. And several of the people that we talked to were not opposed to moving across the border to Royal Oak or Oak Park or someplace else. But the ones that just had this connection to Berkeley, which many of us do, is they want to stay, and they've recognized there is no place to go. Senior housing is a theme that has come over and over again, where if it's multi-housing, make sure it's seniors. I think Ann will have something to add about that with the meeting we had with the Oxford Park Towers people. But for the most part, these guys knew about Dial-A-Ride. A couple of them planned to stay in their house until they died. Mm-hmm. It was just, hey, this is where I'm going to be. You know, when I'm done, come get me. So it was an interesting set of views where, you know, these guys are where we all hope to get to. They've been where we are now, and they're looking, you know, what's next? And they know that there really is nothing for them here in the city of Berkeley.
Or in the city of Huntington Woods.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. The impression I got, and there was 180 people there. I invited myself, and apparently Dean did too. I didn't know. We just happened to show up. There were 18 tables. It was a very positive conversation. Only one table said, we don't want it, if I remember correctly. Everyone else, they had maps of the city, and they had different sizes of blocks with colors. Where would you put them? Well, I don't know if that exercise worked too well, because there's a lot of common things, but they basically, where they put them, they wiped out every commercial property in the community, if my recollection is correct. They know they want it. They know they don't have it, but they don't know how to get it.
Well, they talked about changing the medical buildings on Woodward south of 11 Mile, saying, you know, these aren't fully used. Right. Let's make them into multi-use.
They even talked about going up 3 or 4 stories on top of City Hall.
Yes, they had many creative solutions.
And then there was the one argument they had, we tried to stay back, but we got involved in the discussions, was it's a little bit of back and forth about the golf course. You know, well, take a strip of the golf course. It's a 17-hole course, not an 18-hole course. And put some homes there. Well, they went back and forth with that. But that's not going to happen, of course, right? But that was something that – but the bottom line was they know they need it, but they don't know how to accomplish it. And I wish – I don't recall when the follow-up meeting was, when the planners – report their findings. It's probably gone and passed. I've been out of town the last 3 or 4 weekends, so they mentioned the date, and I don't recall. We probably missed out. It would have been interesting to see what the planners came back with.
Okay. So, Ms. Shadle?
Yeah, I'm happy to talk about the Oxford Tower folks, if that's fair to you. I think they were... To say they were excited and engaged would probably be a little bit of an understatement. But, you know, clearly the one thing that came across, and it was so I was happy and honored to hear it, was that they were very excited where they lived and for their homes, and there's a lot of reasons for that. And I'll just name off a few of them. But I think that I kind of came away with, I think they named it a couple times, that it was difficult for them to imagine what the next generation through might be looking for. You know, I think we heard that a couple times. You know, there were some things thrown out about tiny homes and one-bedroom condos and how important elevators are and whatnot. But really what I walked away from was kind of their tick list of, hey, this is what I need and this is why I'm here. And so I can't imagine another senior not wanting these items. So let me just name a few of them, and I'm sure I'll miss some of them. But the most important really was the sense of community, you know, within their homes, within that immediate surrounding. You know, the fact that the surrounding community, they have a park, they have the ability to go certain places that aren't far away. Of course, they want a grocery store like we all do, right? And they'd love to have it right inside their building. That'd be great too, right? But, you know, they talked about services. I mean, you know, things multiple times we heard them say, all right, one check a month. I don't have to worry about writing checks for utilities. If I have cable, I do have to write that. That's a second check. But everything else is included. I don't have to worry about the maintenance. I don't have to worry about the lawn mowing. Safety was a big issue. The friendliness of the folks that were there. The accessibility, again. And I think, frankly, almost everybody that we talked to, and there's over 20 people, I think it's fair to say, this was the last place they were going to call home, and they're excited about it, and it was some of these items that drew them to that particular location. I'm sure I missed it.
Oh, that's pretty good. While Ann was introducing herself and being nice, I explained to them, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. And that got a good reaction. But what happened was they talked, and as they talked, they realized how special their place is and what it means to them. And then we started talking about the overall population of the city of Berkley and, well, what other options does a group coming behind you have? And it was like a light turned on. They said, yes, this is something they need. But one of the things that just jumped out at me was I would say at least half a dozen of these people said, if you're going to put in multi-housing, make sure it's labeled senior and it's restricted so it stays senior. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't want rock and rollers living below us. Mm-hmm. And so as taking that discussion, you know, going forward, as a planning commissioner, if we talk about doing something that's senior citizen, mm-hmm. our responsibility is to make sure it stays that way so that it doesn't slide and, you know, become kind of mixed and then fall apart. The several of them had just recently left single-family homes, and they said it was wonderful. You know, they didn't have the maintenance. They could play every day. And they talked about the dial-a-ride and how several times a week the bus shows up and takes them to Myers. It takes them to Senior Center. They've got a pretty good setup there. And they all love Berkley. Most of them mm-hmm. did not come from Berkley. They came to Berkley.
Okay. Did anybody attend the high school thing, or was there a high school?
I did.
Okay.
Yeah, we were invited to a class at the high school. The title of the class was called, what was it?
Diversity Council.
Diversity Council.
Diversity Council.
And we basically spoke to the class, and it was a good time, actually. I really liked the kids. They were, as most of the folks in the room probably know, anytime you walk into a classroom in Berkley High School, there's a very small chance that every kid in the classroom is going to actually live in Berkley, because right. we have multiple communities in the district, and that, of course, was the case here. Mm-hmm. I thought that it was interesting to, you know, just get the perspective of these young people on housing in their community and what they like about their community. And, you know, even the kids who don't live in Berkley, there were kids from Huntington Woods and Oak Park, of course, but also there was a kid from West Bloomfield and a kid who lives in Troy. And the kid who lived in Troy, obviously it's a very different community from Berkeley, but she...
I think they lived in an apartment.
Yeah, they lived in an apartment in Troy, but she had a lot of really nice things to say about Berkeley and the way it feels and the way what she likes about the community. So I thought that was kind of interesting. Anytime you talk to a group of high school students, you're going to encounter people who are kind of figuring out who they are and what their view of the world is. And it was kind of interesting in particular to hear some of them talk about their kind of instinctual attraction at that age to kind of vibrant life and multifamily type living, and also try to kind of work through that attraction to understand and empathize with people who would prefer to have a neighborhood of single-family homes that's somewhere else. You know, it was a really interesting conversation. As far as takeaways, I don't really have much in the way of, mm-hmm. you know, something to add to a plan necessarily, but it was a very interesting conversation. I really enjoyed it.
And we spent some time educating them too on zoning and you know, mm-hmm. codes and all that kind of stuff. So
yeah, and I think that
gave a good talk on the history of zoning and the codes. So.
Yeah, and I think that's something you don't typically get in a high school curriculum. Yeah. So that was kind of fun too. But I mean, it was a good time. Like I said, it was some interesting perspectives.
Yeah, and some of were aware of what we're going through right now. Mm-hmm. So. Which was good. It means they're, you know, either their parents are talking about it or they're hearing about it. But yeah, it was interesting. So,
what grade level were they? 11th, 12th grade?
I think mostly 11th and 12th.
Yeah, I think in this case it was all juniors and seniors. Sometimes there are sophomores in that class, but at this moment there are no sophomores.
Okay. All right. Then I guess we want to move on. Next item on the agenda.
is appointment, matter of appointing a Planning Commission liaison to the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. Meets the second Thursday at 7 p.m.
I'm looking for a volunteer.
I'll reiterate, I was on it for several years.
Yes, I know you were, and you don't really have the time for it.
No, I just don't have the time. A good group. They're doing a lot. And with what happened in the last week or so with the issue at the ice arena,
yeah,
I won't say it's going to get exciting, but they've got some big decisions to make that impacts everybody here in Berkeley. So
yeah,
hopefully someone can deal with it and join in.
Mr. Chair, I have the theoretical time, but I have conflicts on Thursday night. That's my problem. I couldn't really go to the meetings, many of them.
Is there anybody else that could pick up the pace?
The second Thursday of every month, I am partying with the Farmington Hills Planning Commission. So I can't make it.
That's a party.
It's actually at exactly that time. So.
And unfortunately, as I've said, and I think on two previous occasions, I cannot take on that that appointment.
I'll do it.
Ms. Buckler says she's going to take it on.
Whoa, slow down.
They have cookies, Miss.
They have cookies.
They do have cookies.
Don't suggest that. People will get angry.
Okay. But anyway, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay, item number.
I don't need to see my boyfriend anyways.
Bring them along. Cookies.
Free cookies.
Item three.
I was just letting Ms. Buckler finish. Discussion regarding bylaws and rules of procedure. We haven't looked at these in a while. The Zoning Board of Appeals had looked at them in depth a while ago with the city attorney's help. I have made those changes. Everything shown as an underline or an overstrike. If you've got any questions.
Is there any questions on it?
I had one. We were eliminating the second public comment.
Yep.
And I just wondered why.
It was something I brought up with the city council and members of the city council and the city manager, because I couldn't figure out why they only had one section of citizens' comments and why we had two, because quite often our meetings are not very well attended and there's usually nobody here. So I said, well, let's just eliminate it and have it at the beginning and be done with it and sort of conform to what the other boards in the city are doing.
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Shado.
So to be clear, we're maintaining citizens' comments at the beginning of the meeting to address anything that's not on the agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's an opportunity for each agenda item for citizens to also comment.
Yep.
Right? Mm-hmm. So we're maintaining that.
Yep.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, my comment is in regards to section 3.8. Last sentence. No member shall abstain from voting on any matter except in the case of a conflict of interest, as provided below, etc. This is new language. It's underlined. Why, just out of curiosity, why was that proposed?
I was looking at the Zoning Board of Appeals ones that were done a couple of years ago or last year. I don't remember the exact. I think the intent of it was that you're appointed to vote and you should vote on things unless there's a conflict of interest. So that's quite simply it, rather than saying it's uncomfortable or I don't, you know. You are supposed to vote.
I don't think anybody can accuse me of ever skipping a vote.
No.
I first was on the Planning Commission. There came up an issue, and I did abstain. And afterwards, I got a lot of flack about doing that because I just couldn't agree one way or the other on that particular matter. But I should have voted, and I probably should have voted. If I couldn't agree on it, I should have just flat out voted. No.
The only comment I will make is I can only see one circumstance where, in the absence of a conflict of interest, somebody may wish to abstain, and that's where, for whatever reason, that person is not prepared to vote, has lacks information on the topic. And I will say maybe through no fault of their own. We get packets, but somebody someday may be uncomfortable because they're put in that situation. Am I going to, you know, put my foot down about this? No, but I want to point that out because the first thing that occurred to me.
Absolutely. I think that's a great point. Again, coming in, if my first meeting was, let's vote on this amendment to the master plan, and I didn't have the 18 months of information behind that, absolutely, I'd best be abstaining. Otherwise, I've done weeks and weeks of homework to attempt to get up to speed on that.
It's a matter of conscience, you know.
Mm-hmm. But you can just vote no because you're unprepared
that's
to
fair.
Vote.
Yeah. That's fair.
One
says something different. I think that says something different.
Yeah, I do too.
Dan, Gary.
One specific instance in which an abstention might make a lot of sense is if you were not able to attend a meeting and you're being asked to vote on the minutes of the meeting.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's correct.
You're supposed to vote on those. You're supposed to vote on them.
You're supposed to vote on them.
Just to watch the video.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair?
Ms. Dean Smith.
I have a couple other items I'd like to talk about, but this particular provision, I noted that it's the Joe Novitzky provision.
Zach's actually Eric Morrell provision, too. He is a huge advocate. You shall vote.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You're put here to vote. You will vote.
Yep.
And we did in I've been here a long time, and maybe you've been here. There were some times where, you know, we will just say your example there. Mm-hmm. I don't feel I'm prepared. Will you explain your position? We go around the table, just like a conflict of interest. And I've abstained a couple times because of a possible conflict of interest. We go around, we decide whether that's really a do you truly believe that will affect your vote? So you are put here to vote, and it's up to you to keep.
Be prepared.
You have the same information the rest of us have, except experience in your situation. But we are put here to vote.
I don't have any problem with it. I just was throwing that out there.
Yes.
If I could, right at the very beginning, we've got at the July meeting, commission shall select by majority vote the chair and vice chair. Now, at our July meeting, we didn't do that.
No.
So I thought we might want to add some kind of an out clause or something that says, you know, should officer selection not occur, you know, due to time constraints or, you know, whatever would be a legitimate reason, it will occur at the following meeting.
Yeah.
I don't like to have something that says we've absolutely done something wrong because we ran out of time.
I think July we didn't have full membership to the Planning Commission. That's why we didn't do it.
And August was a work session.
Open house.
Yes. Yeah. But those are things that we can document and say this is why we did not take action.
Right.
Some kind of circumstances, right?
We had circumstances,
Other than that, you know, just kind of in keeping with what we started with tonight, under Section 2, Paragraph 2, Duties, the building department shall be responsible for the preparation of summary minutes. Again, it's a word, it's not a high-value word, but it kind of restates that the minutes are a summary. And paragraph 4 on page 2, the other meetings, this is where the English teacher comes out. Should the zoning officer be uppercased?
I don't know. I don't think
it's the proper title.
Would you like to do that?
Doesn't matter. It's just it's a question more than anything else.
It's not a title, really, is it?
It's a proper title.
It's not an official title, is it?
No. Okay, when it's the zoning officer. if we're okay with the first paragraph putting something in about deferral of items, we're good. But there's also...
Where are you?
I'm on page 4 now at the very top.
I don't know what I did.
And in my, 10 or 12 years off and on of doing this, we've had meetings where we ran over and we decided just to defer items the following meeting.
I'd like to do that now.
We don't have a provision in here for the deferral of meetings. Is that covered under our rules of order? Correct. Or not deferral of meetings, but deferral of agenda items.
Items. That can be covered under Robert's rules.
Okay,
so
it's covered under Robert's rules, and we need to add nothing here. Amy, under Section 4?
Yes.
Minutes and reports. The building department shall prepare commission meeting minutes.
Gotcha.
Our brains are minute, but they're the meeting minutes. And on the last paragraph, in July, the Planning Commission applications the commission has heard and the actions taken, because it would be actions per application. Other than that, I can't think of any other nits.
Just to clarify some of the language in Section 2 so that I understand. So in the July meeting or as soon thereafter, depending on the circumstance, we're going to vote on chair, vice chair, and secretary to serve for a 12-month period. And that tenure, I guess I'm looking then down at Section 3 as far as tenure. We're taking out the term of 1 year and putting in until their successors are elected and assume office.
That was something the city attorney had recommended.
I mean, it basically means the same thing, right? I mean, really, it's a semantical issue. I just want to make sure I understand that
properly.
That's
pretty good wording, because it prevents the guy from dropping off the chart because we didn't meet our July deadline.
Mm-hmm. Mm, fair enough.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Other comments? Okay.
Okay.
All right.
You want to see them again before you vote on them, or?
I see them again.
Let's see them again.
Okay.
Bring them back. Look at it again. Next item on the agenda.
Liaison reports.
Okay. Who wants to go first?
Nothing to report from environmental.
You want to report on anything on the DDA?
Amy included the minutes in the packets.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So for the chamber, this coming Friday is the State of the City at Farina's. Its cost is $30. So if you're inclined to go and have the time.
$30.
Yeah.
It's this Friday.
Yeah.
Is that a luncheon?
It's a luncheon.
Luncheon.
Yeah, I think it was $25 if you bought your ticket by yesterday.
Oh,
so
that's far away.
Yeah. And then they had the chamber golf outing. They had 62 golfers. Their revenue this year was down a little bit, but they did donate $1,000 to the Holiday Lights Parade from the revenue generated, as well as $1,000 to the Tri-Community Coalition. Mm-hmm. Let's see. I think that was about all that of the big things. And that's about it.
Okay. We've got everybody right.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Zoning Board of Appeals?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay. CBA.
I could be
skipped,
too.
That's right. You had a meeting.
We did. We had two applications. One applicant wanted to build a house on a lot split. So we had a 40-foot width, but he was restricted by, you know, really two things. In this particular case, it was in the part of the block where the driveways changed sides. So he wanted to build a full-size house using 15 feet of setback, you know, 5 on one side, 10 on the other. But because of the driveway change, it couldn't be done. So his application was denied, and he may come back and try for, I think, a 23-foot wide house. We had another applicant who his house was destroyed by fire last July. And since the house was built, the rules have changed. He needed to either build a firewall or move the wall 2.5 inches to the south. We talked about that quite a bit, and the contractor that is planning on doing the rebuild was pretty comfortable that he could build on the existing foundation and you know, come in that 2.5 inches so they would be able to have windows and a regular house. So that applicant was granted their variance. You know, just they have to scoot over 2.5 inches.
All right, City Council, I've attended two meetings in October, believe it or not. The first one was on October the 3rd. We had before them, that was the Vincetta Garage came before them, that recommendation that we had made to council, and they upheld our recommendation for denial for the rezoning. So that was the important thing on that, well, that meeting. I'm going over what transpired in the other meeting. They approved the DDA for the lights, for the holiday lights, and getting that going. And they bought a bunch of equipment for the public safety department for the, I guess it's part of the 911 system and all of that emergency broadcast. They're putting in a lot of new equipment that will tie into Oakland County and give us better services for emergencies and what have you. So a lot of that is going on. And, of course, I think that's pretty much the key things that might interest you folks. The rest of it was appointments and what have you. So with that, I'm going to run around the room here quickly. Mr. Martin Smith, anything tonight?
No, sir.
Mr. Richardson?
Nothing further.
Ms. Pop?
Remember to get to the polls.
I'll second that.
Ms. Shado?
Third.
Fourth.
Mr. Tangeri?
I have nothing to add beyond that.
So that either makes me fifth or sixth. Go vote.
So you want to, Ms. Fanson, anything? Nothing tonight. We have a meeting on Tuesday, the
22nd.
Because the 21st, I think, is council, and we have 22nd for that. And I guess my final comments is, first of all, I'd like to thank the residents for being here tonight. You were very... very good meeting tonight. Everybody was, and we're all jumping around, and hopefully going forward we can get things accomplished in timely fashion and keep people aware of what's going on. Now, with that being said, you're going to be drafting this amendment for council or whatever you're going to do with it.
Well, I'm going to do this with it.
Is that all you're going to do?
Yeah,
is that all it's going to be?
That's
it? Okay. Is that what we're going to send out to Oakland County and all of them?
It depends on what council decides to do.
All right.
We don't do anything until council says.
Okay. But I mean, that's the sheet that's going to go out.
Well, I'm guessing it's not just going to be this. It's going to have the rest of the pages associated with it.
That's what my question was.
But it'll be that, yeah.
So my question is...
My understanding was this was the only page that was going to change, because I think the recommendations without the other five pages would not make sense.
Yeah, the whereas is a different document.
Right.
That's
okay.
The only
but you
thing
want
that changes.
Pages 1 through 5 plus...
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I understood correctly.
Dates would change.
Dates will change.
Yes, dates will change.
So when will all of the, will this be posted for citizens so they can see it or whatever?
I'm going to get it to the city clerk as quickly as I can, and then I don't know what the city clerk's procedure is.
Okay. But it will be out there somewhere before council meeting, I assume. With that said, we do have an election coming up on next week. It's very...
It's two weeks from today.
2 weeks from today is an election day. 35th. And it's important that everybody does execute their rights as a voter to go out and to vote. You hear a lot of people saying, well, I think I'll sit it out.
Don't.
And I'm reminded about this idea of sitting out things. Where would we be if people had set out if our founding fathers said, oh, I don't like the Declaration, let's just sit it out? What would happen if people in the Revolutionary War decided, well, I guess I won't go to Bunker Hill today? In the Civil War, if we had the bloodiest conflicts, what if we just all sat around and didn't do anything? Where would we be? A lot of people have shed blood and tears so that we have the right to get out and vote. And everybody should. Who was registered and old enough should get out and exercise that right. You may not like who some of the people are, but you still need to get out and vote. And with that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay. Made by Commissioner Murad. Seconded by Shado. All those in favor, aye.
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 Meeting is adjourned. Thank you all.
Oh.